Now let us revise Ind AS 105. The name of the Ind AS is non-current assets held for sale and discontinued operation. Directly we don't have a related AS over there, but there was AS 24, that was discontinuing operation, which you might or might not have studied, no problem. Ind AS we have in our syllabus is Ind AS 105, non-current asset held for sale and discontinued operation. Okay, when we take up this Ind AS, we'll study in two different parts. So we'll first concentrate only on the non-current asset which are held for sale. Okay, now you need to remember that when we tell that it's a non-current asset held for sale, we need to understand it applies to non-current asset which are held for sale, and we also need to apply to disposal groups which are held for sale. So this standard is applicable for non-current asset also held for sale and a disposal group which is held for sale. What do you mean by a disposal group held for sale? Disposal group held for sale means group of assets and the related liabilities which are going to be transferred together in a single transaction. They are known as disposal groups. It may be a part of CGU, it can be a single CGU, it can be group of CGU, it can be anything. So disposal group is basically a summation of assets and sometimes summation of assets and liabilities which are going to be transferred together in a single transaction, that is a disposal group. And when an asset, non-current asset is held for sale, or when a disposal group of is held for sale, this standard is applicable. Now this standard is applicable for the requirements of this standard, the classification requirement and the presentation requirement of this standard is applicable to all non-current assets which are held for sale, or all assets all of disposal group, entire disposal group which is held for sale. So entire disposal group which is held for sale and the non-current asset which are held for sale, classification and presentation is requirement is applicable to all of them. However, the measurement requirement of this standard is applicable to all that non-current assets or the non-current asset which are part of disposal group with certain exceptions. Means the measurement aspect of this standard is only applicable to the non-current asset, either individually or non-current asset which are part of non-current asset which are individually or non-current asset which are part of disposal group, on that only the measurement concept is applicable, and that too with certain exceptions. Means in case of certain non-current assets, even if individually or even if they are part of disposal group, measurement aspect of this standard is not applicable. Okay, so what are that non-current assets to with the measurement aspect of this standard is not applicable? Deferred tax asset, because they are covered in Ind AS 12, over there they are measured. Classification presentation requirement of this standard is applicable. Then employee benefit asset, they are covered in Ind AS 19. Financial assets, covered in Ind AS 105. Biological asset, covered in Ind AS 41. Insurance contract assets, assets arising from insurance contract or under insurance contract, Ind AS 104. So on them the measurement scope of this standard is not applicable, but classification presentation requirement may be applicable if they are non-current asset which are held for sale or they are part of disposal group which are held for sale. Clear? Now, normally a non-current asset which is classified as non-current asset as per Ind AS 1, if an asset is classified as a non-current asset as per Ind AS 1, it will remain as a non-current asset till the time it is reclassified over here as current. Till the time it is reclassified over here as held for sale, the day it is reclassified over here as per Ind AS 105 as held for sale, then it can be considered as current. Till that time it will be considered as non-current asset only. So normally a non-current asset remains a non-current asset as under Ind AS 1 unless it is classified as held for sale over here. Okay. Next, there are certain definitions which are given over here. Definitions of non-current asset are given, definitions of current asset are given. Okay. And one more thing is there in the scope aspect. In scope, it is given that when the non-current asset is held for sale or disposal group is held for sale, it is covered over here in the standard. Similarly, if a non-current asset or disposal group is held for distribution to owners in their capacity of owners, then that is also covered over here as held for sale only. Treated in the same manner. So that is the scope of the standard. Okay, so we have started with the scope. In the objective, we have just considered only one part, the assets which are held for sale. I'll be deliberating that in the later point in time, not now. Okay. And we know when we say non-current asset held for sale, we have to together tell disposal group held for sale. Okay. And the classification presentation requirement is applicable to all the non-current assets held for sale, all the disposal group held for sale. But the measurement aspect is applicable only to non-current assets of which are held for sale or non-current assets which are there in disposal group. In that case also they are not applicable for certain non-current assets, that is Ind AS 12, that deferred tax asset, Ind AS 19, that employee benefit asset, financial asset, Ind AS 109, biological asset, Ind AS 41, and that insurance contract assets Ind AS 104. So on them measurement aspect is not available. Definition of non-current asset is other than current. Current assets are which are expected to be realized, intended to be sold or consumed within the normal operating cycle. So over here raw material etc. can be considered. Then the asset which are primarily held for the purpose of trading. So we are buying and selling. So that stock can be considered over here. And any other thing which are expected to be realized within 12 months from the reporting period, they can be considered as current asset. Over here in C point, it is expected to be realized from the reporting period. So from the end of the reporting period, within 1 year, if you are going to realize it, it's a current asset. Then cash and cash equivalents, they are current asset unless if they are restricted to be realized or repatriated for at least 12 months. Restrictions is there for more than 12 months, then it is not current on that. Example is like this, ki I have a cash balance in a Ugandan bank in Uganda, a country in Africa, and the government over there has put up a restrictions on repatriation or usage for next 12 months, etc. Usage is not possible. Then in that case, I cannot say that is a current. I will have to consider as a non-current thing. Then the disposal group is defined, which is already done. It's a group of assets which are going to be sold together in a single transaction along with the related liabilities. It can be a single CGU, part of CGU, or group of CGU. Then CGU is defined. The CGU definition, fair value definition, cost to sale definition are same as that given in Ind AS 36, which we have revised earlier. CGU, fair value, and cost to sale. CGU, smallest group of assets which generate independent cash flows, which are largely independent of other assets. So that is known as CGU. So basically, smallest group of assets which generate independent cash flows are CGU. Fair value, regular definition is there. Cost to sell, regular definition before finance and before income tax we have to consider. So these are certain definitions which are given. Discontinued operation, though, we'll be discussing that totally differently. So I'm not discussing discontinued operation entirely over here. Next point comes as what to do in case of non-current asset held for sale or disposal group held for sale. Whenever there's a non-current asset or disposal group held for sale, means basically the amount is going to be recorded principally to sale rather than use. And we can say that non-current asset or disposal group is held for sale when it is available for immediate sale in its present condition and the sale should be highly probable. Then only we can say held for sale, or else we cannot say it's held for sale. Okay, so what do you mean by available for immediate sale in the present condition? Means it should be directly available for sale. However, if you say that it is vital for ongoing operation, however you say that it is going to be refurbished before sale, then it is not available for sale in immediately in the present condition, then it is not considered as held for sale. But if an asset is subject to any terms and conditions which are usual or customary, let us say I am selling some immovable property and there is a usual or customary term that the buyer will check that and the sales registration will happen and it will take some time, then I can say that's fine, that is allowed. Then I can say that immovable property is available for immediate sale in the present condition. So very important that to be considered as held for sale, that non-current asset or disposal group, whatever be the case, that should be available for immediate sale in the present condition. Some usually or customary terms and conditions are allowed, that is not a problem. Still, it will be considered as held for sale. However, if the asset is being used or ongoing operations as of now, vital for ongoing operation, or the asset is being refurbished and it is going to be refurbished so that the value enhances and then only you are going to sell it, so it is going to be sold in distant future, so I cannot say it is available for sale immediately in its present condition. Okay, accordingly examples are given by the insured over there. Next is, sale should also be highly probable. There should be both the points should be there, that it should be available for sale immediately in its present condition and the sale should be highly probable also. What do you mean by highly probable? Highly probable means significantly high, significantly more than probable. Probable is like more than 50%. So significantly more than probable is like more than 80%. I can say highly probable. That more than 80% is just a numerical thing for knowledge purpose, not for exam purpose. Okay. Now, but for exam purpose, what is important? Exam purpose is significantly more likely than probable. How you will say that it is significantly more likely than probable? If following five conditions are fulfilled, then I can say significantly more likely than probable, it's highly probable. And all of that five conditions should be fulfilled. The first condition is appropriate level of management should be committed to plan to sell. Active program to trace the buyer and complete the transaction must be initiated. Sale should be marketed at a reasonable price, which is reasonable to its current fair value. The goods that non-current asset or disposal group should be marketed for sale at a reasonable price, which is reasonable to current fair value. If you are not marketing at a reasonable price, you cannot say it's Sale is highly probable. Then you should expect that sale should be expected to be completed within 1 year from the date of classification as held for sale. So I am classifying held for sale on 1/7. So within 1 year, I should be expecting that sale should get complete. Then only I can say sale is highly probable. And significant changes or withdrawal of plan is unlikely. When all of these conditions are fulfilled, I can say that the sale is highly probable. And when the sale is highly probable and when that asset is available for immediate sale in the present condition, I can say that that non-current asset or that disposal group is held for sale. Clear? Then what happens in case of loss of control in subsidiary? Let us say if the management gets committed to loss of control in a subsidiary, then it's like that subsidiary is held for sale. Then whatever assets of and liabilities of that subsidiary are included in my consolidated financial statement, they will be shown as assets will be shown as held for sale assets and liability will be shown as held for sale liability only. Obviously, even if we retain some non-controlling interest in future, that doesn't matter. But if a management is committed to sell a subsidiary and that involves loss of control of that subsidiary, then it is the assets and the liabilities of that subsidiary in my consolidated financial statement will be shown as held for sale only. Clear? Now, there's one exception to 1 year clause. What was that 1 year clause? That it should be expected that the sale should be expected to be completed within 1 year from the date of classification. Now that's an expectation. An expectation can change later on. Let us say if there's a delay and that delay is because of some events and circumstances which is beyond our control, like coronavirus, but still the entity is committed to plan to sell, then it can continue to be held for sale and you can continue the accounting for held for sale even if the 1 year has lapsed. But there should be an evidence available that entity is still committed to sell that. Okay, next. Held for sale includes held for exchange. So if I held an asset for exchange, so it is like I have held an exchange asset for sale, but that exchange should have commercial substance. What do you mean by exchange as commercial substance? I have clearly taught you that in Ind AS 16. If I am giving a private jet and taking a building in return, the cash flows from the private jet and the cash flows from the building are substantially going to be different. Then I can say that exchange as a commercial substance, such transactions can be covered over here. So say held for exchange is considered as held for sale only. Okay, next. Many times it can happen that I acquire an asset only with a view of subsequent disposal, and that too within 1 year from the date of acquisition. So I acquire an asset only with a view of subsequent disposal, and that too I expect to dispose within 1 year from the date of acquisition. Then from the date of acquisition only that asset is considered as held for sale. However, in such a scenario, on the date of acquisition, a 3 months time is given, a short term time, short period of 3 months is given to make the asset ready. This was not available earlier in case of normal non-current asset. So when you buy an asset with a view of disposal only and that disposal is expected within 1 year from the date of acquisition only, then it is considered as held for sale from the date of acquisition only, but the standard gives you a 3 months period extra so that you can meet the classification criteria. But 1 year will always be counted from the date of acquisition only. Next. Let us say there is an asset and that asset as on 31st March is a normal asset, non-current asset only. After 31st March but before approval, the held for sale conditions are fulfilled. So as on the balance sheet date, what to do? Do nothing. It's a non-adjusting event. Max to max, what you can do is you can give a disclosure if it is material. Okay, next. What if the asset is held for distribution to owners? So that too we have discussed. If an asset is held for distribution to the owners in the capacity of owners, it is treated like a held for sale asset only and accordingly accounting will be done. Next. What happens is a non-current asset is abandoned but not sold or not held for sale. If a non-current asset is there, let us say I have a machinery, it is just abandoned. It is neither sold, it is not disposed, it is not held for sale, it is just abandoned and kept aside. In that case, there's a chances that the value in use of that asset is going to be recovered by use only in future. In that case, that abandoned asset is not considered as held for sale asset. So that abandoned asset is neither held for sale, neither it is de-recognized. It will be normally there in the books. It will be just depreciated basically as per Ind AS 16. Max to max, you can do impairment testing on that Ind AS 36. Okay. So if there's an asset which is abandoned but not disposed, not held for sale, so it is not in this Ind AS. Next. So what will happen if a non-current asset or disposal group is classified for held? See, if it fulfills the condition, if the non-current asset or disposal group is considered as classified as held for sale based on the above condition, then it will be measured at lower of carrying amount or fair value less cost to sell. Lower of carrying amount or fair value less cost to sell. It will be measured accordingly. Okay. So what happens if a non-current asset, which is just a newly non-acquired asset, basically what will happen if there's a newly acquired asset or a newly acquired group of asset and it is considered as held for sale from the date of acquisition only, In case of newly acquired asset or disposal group which is considered as held for sale from the acquisition date only, how will get the carrying amount then? How will do that carrying amount of fair value less cost of sale which is lower? In case of newly acquired asset which is classified as held for sale from the date of acquisition date only, then try to calculate the carrying amount had it not been classified as held for sale, and whatever is that amount, take that amount and then compare that amount with fair value less cost of sale. Whichever is lower is your carrying amount at which that asset will be recognized and continued ahead. Because normally carrying amount will not be there, so whatever would have been the carrying amount had it not been classified as held for sale, whatever be that index 16 etc, then cost will be there. That amount of fair value less cost of sale which is lower, at that it will be recognized. If the asset is acquired under business combination and from the initial acquisition only it is held for sale, so let us say there's a business combination, A takes over B, so it takes over B, so it takes over four assets. Out of that four assets, it decides to keep three and one asset is held for sale immediately on the acquisition only. In that case, it will be measured as per first to business combination at fair value, and then it will be compared at fair value less cost to sell over here and 105, which is lower. So fair value or fair value less cost to sell, which is lower? So obviously then it will be measured at fair value less cost to sell only then. So if the asset is acquired as a part of business combination and immediately if it is held for sale, then directly you record it at fair value less cost to sell only, because that will only be lower. Next, let us say there's a non-current asset normally used in the business. Normally we apply all the Ind AS 16, 36, etc. Now one fine day after certain years that non-current asset is held for sale, then what to do? Then they say before applying held for sale, before applying that non-current asset held for sale 105 accounting, kindly apply all the other Ind AS which is applicable, which is possible, get the carrying amount as per that application of all the Ind AS earlier, and then whatever you get the value, then afterwards that after that only you will apply 105. So you'll apply 16 36 38 etc etc, whatever is the case, then get the value as on the date of held for sale and then apply this 105. Okay, now sir, what will happen in case of disposal group? In case of disposal group, what you need to do is, in case of disposal group will have a lot of assets and liabilities. Out of that, certain assets and liabilities will be there to which the measurement aspect of this Ind AS will not be applicable. You know, the measurement aspect of this Ind AS is applicable only on the non-current asset which are within the disposal group, and that too only on the specific non-current asset, is not applicable to that deferred tax asset, etc. So let us say there is a disposal group which is held for sale, then what to do? In case of disposal group held for sale, what you need to do? In that disposal group, whatever assets and liabilities are there which are not within the measurement scope of this standard, example current assets, other liabilities or non-current asset like deferred tax assets which are not within the scope of this standard. So whatever assets and liabilities which are not within the measurement scope of this standard, kindly measure them as per the respective Ind AS. Then get the total carrying amount of that disposal group. The total carrying amount of the disposal group is compared with the total fair value less cost of disposal of the disposal group, and the reduction is done at this group level and not at individual level. So in case of disposal group, you have to calculate the value of assets and liabilities which are not within the scope of this standard as per the applicable Ind AS. Then get the total carrying amount of the group including all the assets and liabilities, compare with the fair value less cost of disposal of the group, and do the testing at the group level in case of disposal group held for sale. Clear? Next, once an asset or disposal group is held for sale, the depreciation amortizations of the asset in that group will stop. However, the interest will continue. Why the interest will continue? Interest on liability will continue because liability are not within the measurement scope of this standard, and therefore they will be measured as per the different standards like 109 effective amortization method. So the interest on that liabilities will continue. Okay. Next, so how that loss is measured? Now, be it a non-current asset which is held for sale or disposal group which is held for sale, we will compare the carrying amount and we will compare with fair value less cost of disposal and the losses booked. The loss booked in this standard is also considered as impairment loss, but it will be named as impairment loss under 105. This loss will be over and above loss booked in other standards. So let us say if there's a disposal group held for sale, first kindly apply other standards, get the value of that disposal group as per other standard, book the loss gain as per other standards, come over here. Then take the total carrying amount of the disposal group, total the fair value less cost of the disposal group, and book the loss of the disposal group over here. This will be over and above the loss which is booked on the other standards. I'll be taking up the example for this point also. The example is like this. Let us say there's a asset, there's a disposal group which has so many assets over there. 31st March value are given, that is year end, and then 1st of August value is given. 31st March that group was a normal group that was not held for sale. On 1st of August it is first time considered as held for sale. Then what to do? Whatever values you have as on 31st March, you have to bring it as on 1st of August. So whatever is the difference between the values as on 31st March and values as on 1st, first kindly apply the respective Ind AS and kindly come bring the values as on 1st of August. Kindly bring the values as on 1st of August. Means this is that point. First, before coming to Ind AS 105, let us say if the Ind AS 105 is applicable from 1st of August, then before coming to Ind AS 105, kindly apply all the other Ind AS. Kindly book the gain or loss as per the respective Ind AS and then only come to 105. So let us say carrying amount as on 1st of March is 31st of March is 16,000 and carrying amount on 1st of August is 14,100. The gap between the two, 1,100, that is a loss which is booked as per that respective standard. It can be 1642, 109, whatever standard is applicable. Then once you have applied all the other standard, 14,900 is the base for application of 105. Now 14,900 is the carrying amount of the disposal group, carrying amount of the disposal group as per 105. Now this will be compared with fair value less cost of disposal of the disposal group. Now fair value less cost of disposal of the disposal group is, let us assume, 13,000. So carrying amount of the disposal group for 105 is 14,900, whereas fair value less cost of disposal of the disposal group is 13,000. And now we'll compare disposal group level. At disposal group level, there is a loss of 1,900, and it will, that loss will be booked at disposal group level. Sir, how that loss will be booked? They say whenever there is a loss as per at the group level, then it, the order of allocation will be as per Ind AS 36. Order of allocation will be as per Ind AS 36 means what? Means when you are allocating the loss, first it will be adjusted against goodwill and then it will be adjusted against non-current assets which are within the measurement scope. So order is as per Ind AS 36, but you have to be very specific. Loss has to be divided only among the non-current assets which are within the measurement scope of the standard and not to the all the assets. So whatever the loss is there in our example, that loss of 1,900 over here, the gap between 14,900 and 13,000, the loss of 1,000, that will only be distributed to non-current assets which are within the measurement scope of the standard, and that too in the order as per Ind AS 36. Means first against goodwill and then as per 36 rest against balance asset in the carrying amount of that asset. So balance against this property, plant, equipment and building in the ratio of the carrying amount of property, plant and goodwill, building. It won't be applied to inventory, it won't be applied to investments and equity, because inventory is not within the scope of the standard. It's a current asset, measurement scope of the standard, and the investment in equity instrument is not within the measurement scope of the standard because it's a financial asset. See, try to understand, this standard measurement scope is applicable only to non-current asset, and in that also only to non-current asset which are specified, except that deferred tax asset, financial assets, etc. It is not applicable to current assets, it is not applicable to liabilities, etc. So accordingly the loss is distributed only to non-current assets which are within the measurement scope of the standard, and that too first against goodwill and then against other assets in the ratio. So that's all about that loss part of that. So basically, whether the loss is of an individual asset or loss is of the disposal group, the loss is recognized to the extent it is not recognized as per the other standard, and the loss is recognized against a non-current asset which are the part of this group as per the order given in Ind AS 36. The non-current asset which are part of measurement aspect of the standard in the ratio in the order given in Ind AS 36. Okay. Now sometimes there can be gain also subsequently. Now subsequently again the asset is measured at fair value less cost to sell on every reporting period, and so subsequently there can be gain because the fair value less cost to sell can increase in future. If there is a subsequent gain, then the gain is recognized, but that gain is recognized only to the extent of loss booked earlier under this standard as impairment loss or loss booked earlier under Ind AS 36 as impairment loss. That's it. So if the loss is booked under this standard as impairment loss or loss is booked under Ind AS 36 as impairment loss, then only that much only reversal is allowed for that non-current asset. So if there's a non-current asset on which loss is booked and now there's a gain on that non-current asset which is held for sale, then the gain on that non-current asset which is held for sale will be booked only to the extent of loss booked either under this standard or Ind AS 36 as impairment loss. So this second paragraph is on gain, but gain of individual asset. First paragraph is on loss, loss of individual asset, non-current asset held for sale, or loss of disposal group held for sale. Second part is of gain, but gain of only individual non-current asset which is held for sale. This third paragraph is gain about disposal group which is held for sale. Okay, so for that we directly discuss with the help of the example over here. Example for a gain is like this, that Let us say there is an asset for 1,20,000. Now fair value less cost to sell has become 1 lakh. So we have booked a loss as per 105, and that name, loss is named as impairment loss. Then later on again it becomes 85,000 fair value less. So again there is a loss of 15,000 which we book as per Ind AS 105. So 20,000 and 15,000, total 35,000 loss is booked as per Ind AS 105 as impairment loss. No loss is booked earlier, let us say, else in 36 also for that asset. Now later on again the fair value less cost of disposal becomes 1,25,000. Now there's a gain. So now this gain, total gain of 40,000, but that total gain of 40,000 will be restricted to 35,000. That is total loss booked under this standard as impairment loss or Ind AS 36 as impairment loss. Over here we had assumed that there's an impairment loss only in this standard, so it will be restricted to 35,000 only. So that is this point, that the gain will be restricted to the impairment loss booked on that non-current asset either under this standard or Ind AS 36, not more than that. Okay, next, what to be done for the gain in case of a disposal group? So let us discuss few examples for the same. Let us first discuss the loss of disposal group again and then the gain of the disposal group. Everyone ready for that? Now let us discuss the loss of the disposal group. So I had already given you an example for disposal group, where what we had done is we had taken up an insured example where the book, in the books it was at 16,000. From 16,000 to 14,900 it was brought as per other standards, not as per, it was as per 240, etc, etc. Then this 14,900 was compared to 13,000 and there's a loss of 1,900 booked as per this standard 105. And it was brought to 13,000. This was the example which we had just considered, that earlier it was 16,000, 105 was applicable on 1,8, so we brought it to 14,900. That was as per other standards. Once it is under 105, then what we do, we calculate the total carrying amount of the disposal group after application of that respective standards. We compare it with the fair value less cost of disposal of that disposal group and book the loss at disposal group. And there was a loss of 1,900 at disposal group level, and that is booked as per Ind AS 36 order against non-current asset which are within the measurement scope of the standard. So first against goodwill and then to other non-current asset which are the within the measurement scope of the standard in the ratio of their carrying amount. And accordingly now we have brought that amount to 13,000. So let us continue that example of 13,000 ahead if we want to. And this is an extra example which I am giving, which is not there in your module. Now video students, you can accordingly click a photo of this or something like that. Now what is this? Let us say we have got this carrying amount revised and these are the values. This is the total 13,000. Now let us say after that again we get a year end. When we get a year end, the standard says that it is at disposal group level. The first you need to calculate the carrying amount of all the assets in that disposal group, and whatever assets are not within the measurement scope of the standard, you have to apply the other Ind AS and get the carrying amount. So accordingly we have got the carrying amount for goodwill, PPE building, that remains the same, but the inventory and investment in equity can change because they are not within the measurement scope of the standard. The other standards will apply, and we have total got the total carrying amount as 12,600. Earlier we had a carrying amount of 13,000. Now there is a loss of 400. This loss of 400 is basically because the inventory and the investment in equity is measured as per the other standard. So that loss will be booked as per other standard. So now we get the total carrying amount of disposal group, and disposal group will be measured in under 105 totally only. So we get the carrying amount of disposal group as 12,600. We will calculate fair value less cost to sell of the disposal group at disposal group level. Let us assume it is 12,000. Again we have an extra loss of 600. What to do of that extra loss? Again that extra loss of 600 will be distributed to what? It will be distributed only to non-current asset which are within the measurement scope of the standard. So now goodwill has become zero. So now PPE and building has left. So it will be distributed to PPE and building in the ratio of 3,835:5,465. That's it. So every time when there's a disposal group, what you need to do, first you need to take the carrying amount of that disposal group, and in that if there are assets and liabilities which are not within the measurement scope of the standard, kindly apply the other standard, get the total amount, get the total carrying amount of the disposal group, compare the fair value less cost of disposal at disposal group level, and book the loss at disposal group level. Whatever is the loss at disposal group, that will be distributed only to the non-current asset which are within the measurement scope of the standard as per Ind AS 105, because other assets and liabilities, they will be measured as per their respective Ind AS. Okay, now this was loss completely. Now let us take up like an example for gain for that disposal group. So let us just reconsider that earlier example and we'll modify it a bit. Okay, so I'm taking up an example for the gain. The example for the gain at disposal group level can be, let us say that there's a disposal group which had a carrying amount of 16,000 on earlier year 31/3 of the last year. Okay, then on 1/8 of the current year it was held for sale and we had a carrying amount of 14,900. So when it is held for sale, 105 is applicable on that date. First apply other Ind AS, get the value and then only apply 105. And therefore there is a gap of 1,100 which will be booked as per other standards. Then once it is in 105, this carrying amount as per 105 is compared with the fair value less cost of sale. Let us assume fair value less cost of sale was that 13,000 and there is a loss of 1,900 which will be booked as per 105, and as per 105 this loss of 1,900 will only be distributed to non-current assets which are within the measurement scope of this standard. So accordingly we have distributed that 1,900 loss first against, and that too the order is as per Ind AS 36, means first against goodwill and then against other assets in the ratio of the carrying amount. And that too non-current asset which are within the measurement aspect. So only against these two assets. Inventory is not within the measurement scope of this standard, and investment in equity instrument. Why inventory is not there? It's a current asset. Why investment in equity instrument is not there? Because it's a financial asset. Okay. So accordingly we got this carrying amount 13,000. So I'm continuing that example with 13,000 now, but with a gain this time. So let us say on 1/8 we had booked the loss. The carrying amount will like this 13,000. Now there is a year end 31st March of the next year. First thing what you need to do on 31st March of next year is kindly calculate the carrying amount of all the assets and liabilities which are not within the measurement scope as per that respective standard and total carrying amount of the disposal group. So I have calculated the total carrying amount of the disposal group. Goodwill will be zero only. PPE and building will remain the same. However, inventory and investment can change because they are measured as per other standard, and we get the total carrying amount of that disposal group as 13,300. It was 13,000 earlier, it has now become 13,300. There is a gap of 300, and that gap of 300 is because inventory and that investment in equity is measured as per other standards. So that gain or loss will be booked as per that respective standard, no problem over there. But we are interested in the total carrying amount now. Total carrying amount is 13,300. Now we will go at disposal group level when we are in 105. When we are in 105, we will go at disposal group level. And at disposal group level, we calculate fair value less cost of disposal. Let us say fair value less cost of disposal is 13,500. Now try to understand, when the fair value of cost of disposal is 13,500, basically what has happened, that 13,000 has become 13,500. But out of that, 300 is already booked as per other standard. So should we book that 300 gain again? The answer is no. So what we'll be doing is, now we'll be booking that gain of only 200. That is the gap between 13,300 and 13,500. Because the gap between 13,000 and 13,300, that is booked already as per understanding. So whenever there's a gain, we have to be very careful that only the gain which is not booked as per other standard will be booked over here. Same was the case with loss. If there's a loss as per other standard, that 400 in this earliest example was already booked as per other standard. So we booked the balance loss only. So total asset was 13,000, which has now become 12,000. Total loss was 1,000. Out of that, 400 was booked as per other standard. So balance 600 was booked over here. Because if the loss is already booked as per other standard, we don't book it again. Same way over here in gain. So if the gain is already booked as per other standard, we don't book it again. So if there is a carrying amount of 13,000 and now it has become as 13,500, total gain is of 500, out of which 300 is already booked as per other standard. So now the balance 200 gain will only be booked. Now we have to be very careful. When we book that balance gain of 200, they say that this balance gain of 200 will be restricted to loss booked earlier. Balance with gain of 200 will be restricted to loss booked earlier, and that too on the non-current asset which are within the scope of the standard, either as per this standard or as per Ind AS 36. So whatever is loss which is booked on the non-current asset which are part of disposal group and which are covered in the measurement scope of the standard, and whatever loss is booked as per this standard or Ind AS 36 as impaired, that much only gain can be reversed. And in our example, if we consider, as per this standard or Ind AS 36, whatever loss is booked is only 1,900. Rest loss is booked as per other standards, and that too on the non-current asset which are within the scope. So non-current asset which are within the scope of this standard and the loss booked under this standard or Ind AS 36 is 1,900 only. Rest is booked as per other standards, not as per this standard or 36 or etc. And that too on non-current asset which are within the scope. So only 1,900 is booked on non-current asset which are within the measurement scope, and that too under this standard or 36. So they say that this gain of 200 will be restricted to 1,900. 200 we have to restrict it to 1,900. So 200 only will be considered. 200 restricted to one. See, if I say 2000 restricted to 1900, to 1900 is considered. But if I say 200 is restricted to 1900, that 200 gain will be considered. And now this 200 gain will be distributed in the ratio as given in Ind AS 36. And in Ind AS 36, whenever you want to distribute the gain will never be distributed in goodwill. But the gain will be distributed to other non-current assets which are within the measurement scope of the standard, and that too in the ratio of the carrying amount. So accordingly, gain will be distributed only to PP and building in our example, non-current asset which are within the measurement scope. Gain is never distributed to goodwill because the distribution is as per Ind AS 36, and accordingly the distribution will happen. And accordingly, I have explained you this entire paragraph by giving extra examples. In fact, the example given by the insured was extended by me. Accordingly, gain for a disposal group, first thing, whatever gain is already considered as per other standard, they will not be considered again. That is A point. And B point is that gain is restricted to the loss booked on that non-current asset which are within the measurement scope, and that too loss booked under this standard or Ind AS 36. So that A and B point I have considered. And what is the order? Be it the gain distribution or be it the loss distribution. Whenever the gain is distributed or whenever this loss is, it is always distributed to non-current asset which are within the scope of measurement, and the order of distribution is as per Ind AS 36. So whenever the loss is distributed, first against goodwill and then to against other asset in the carrying amount. Whenever the gain is distributed, never against goodwill but against other assets in the ratio of carrying amount, and always it is to the non-current asset which are within the measurement scope. To them only it will be distributed because other assets are already taken care by other Ind AS. Accordingly, it is repeated. Now, what happens when ultimately that asset, non-current asset which is held for sale, or disposal group which is held for sale, ultimately disposed, sale. Whenever the sale happens, regular entry is passed, cash bank account debit or receivable account debit to asset carrying amount, whatever is the new carrying amount as of now, difference goes to P&L. So normal derecognition entry is passed as per the respective Ind AS. And accordingly, I am completed with this part. Okay. Now, there are few paragraphs still left, so I continue this revision in the next session. Okay, so we stop over here. Good morning everyone. We continue with the revision of Ind AS 105, which we had stopped last time. Okay, we were discussing recognition of impairment loss and reversal thereof. So I have already told you ki when there is a non-current asset which is held for sale or disposal group which is held for sale, you recognize the loss when it is measured to fair value less cost to sell. Obviously, you will be measuring the loss in this standard to the extent it is not already measured in the other standard, and we had taken up the examples regarding the same. I had given you the examples that regarding this point, that if the loss is already measured as per this other standard, so it will not be measured over here and the balance loss will be booked over here. So 16,000 to 14,900 was not considered in this standard, it was as per other standard, but 14,900 to 13,000, that was booked as per this standard. Okay, now then we considered that when you are booking the loss at disposal group level, do one thing, that kindly first take up the assets and liabilities of disposal group to with the measurement aspect of the standard is not applicable, measure as per their respective standards, book the gain or loss as per respective standard, then go at disposal group level, take the carrying amount at disposal group level, compare with fair value less cost of disposal at disposal group level, and get the loss at disposal group level. Now this loss of disposal group level can be allocated in the order given in Ind AS 36, and that too only on non-current assets which are within the measurement scope of the standard. And in that order, first we'll allocate to goodwill and then to other assets in the ratio of the carrying amount. So we'll be allocating only to the non-current assets which are within the measurement scope of the standard. Those non-current assets which are not in the measurement scope of the standard, or those current assets or liabilities, will won't allocate the loss which is there at the disposal group level. Okay, those which are not the part of measurement aspect of the standard, the non-current asset which are not the part of the measurement aspect, or the current assets are totally out, or the liabilities which are totally out, they will be measured as per their respective standards. Okay, then subsequently there can be gain also. In gain, there are two paragraphs. One is gain for that individual non-current assets, and other is gain for that disposal group level. If there's a gain subsequently, what happens is, gain is measured when that fair value less cost to sell increases in future. But when you are measuring that gain for an individual non-current asset which is held for sale, the gain which can be recognized over here as per this standard will be maximum restricted to the cumulative impairment loss booked on that individual non-current asset earlier, either under this Ind AS or under Ind AS 36. So whatever maximum loss we have booked under other standards, the gain will be restricted to that amount. Okay. But that too impairment loss, and that impairment loss under 105 or 36, the gain will be restricted to that amount. And basically I had given one example for the same. If I will try to recollect for you all, that example was like this. that there was an individual non-current asset which was held for sale. We booked a loss earlier, 20,000, then a loss of 15,000. Total 35,000 loss was booked as an impairment loss, either this standard 105 or 36, let us say. In that case, if future there is a gain, the gain can be booked under the standard only to the extent of loss booked either under 105 or 36 for that asset as an impairment loss. So it will be restricted to 35. That accordingly we had considered this example. Similarly, we can consider the gain for disposal group level. In the case of disposal group level, you can consider the gain. But first, what you need to do is, when you are at disposal group level, kindly measure all the assets and liabilities which are not within the measurement scope of the standard as per the respective standard. Book the gain or loss as per that respective standard. Over and above that, if there is a gain, then that is booked over here as per 105. And that too, that is booked only on non-current assets which are within the measurement scope of the standard. And that too, only to the extent of impairment loss booked either under Ind AS 36 or 105 on that non-current asset which are within the measurement scope of the standard. And for that I gave you this example of this disposal group, that 13,000 was converted to 13,500. Out of that, 13,000 to 13,300, that 300 was as per other standards, so it will be booked as per other standards. Now that from 13,300 to 13,500, that 200 is a basically a gain under 105, which is at disposal group level, because comparing at disposal, that gain of 200, which is for the disposal group, which is as per the standard, will be booked only on the non-current assets which are within the measurement scope of the standard, and that will be restricted to the loss booked earlier on that non-current asset which are within the measurement scope of the standard. And in our example, that loss booked on that non-current asset which are within the measurement scope of the standard as per this index or 36 was 1900. So that 200 was restricted to 1900 and gain of that 200 was booked. Okay, and whenever you book a gain, again the order will be as per index 36 only. Again the order will be as per index 36 only. Now order will be as per index 36 means gain order as per, so you will never book the gain for goodwill and you will book the gain for other non-current asset which are within the measurement scope of the standard in the ratio of the carrying amount. So that is what we had discussed about this. Okay, then there are a few paragraphs which were there earlier also. Once a non-current asset is held for sale or disposal group is held for sale, the depreciation amortization on them will stop immediately. However, interest etc. will continue because that is continuing as per the other standards, or interest on liabilities will continue because liabilities are not within the measurement scope of this standard. So liabilities which are part of disposal group, but they will be measured as per their respective standards. So interest etc. will continue, but depreciation and amortization will stop. Okay, and then we can go ahead now. Are you getting this much? Okay, the next point is like this, that one more thing. Let us say a non-current asset is held for sale or a disposal group is held for sale, whatever be the case. Now it is ultimately sold, it is ultimately derecognized. So what entry will pass at the time of derecognition? Very simple entry: cash bank account debit or receivable account debit. Cash bank or receivable account debit based on accrual system of accounting. Two, asset. Now asset will be cancelled at whatever is the present carrying amount, and the difference will go to P&L. Normal derecognition journal entry will be passed when that non-current asset held for sale or that disposal group is derecognized. Okay everyone, and accordingly that part is complete. So we can go for the next part. What will happen if there's a change in plan to sell? Let us say we had a plan earlier that non-current asset is held for sale or disposal group is held for sale, and now that plan is changed. So they will no more be considered as held for sale, they won't be shown as held for sale. Okay, now when that happens, how should we measure? When a non-current asset ceases to be held for sale, when a non-current asset ceases to be held for sale, as per para 26 of this Ind AS, we don't remember the para number, just for reference, when a non-current asset ceases to be held for sale, earlier it was held for sale and measured at carrying amount of fair value less cost of disposal which is lower, and now today it ceases to be held for sale because it does not fulfill the condition. When that happens, as per para 26 of Ind AS 105, it will be measured at lower of the following. And what is that lower? What you need to do is, see, earlier one fine day though it was held for sale, now it is no more held for sale. So the date it was considered as held for sale, just before that, whatever is the carrying amount, take that amount minus the depreciation for the balance period. So you'll get one amount. Second amount is recoverable amount on the date it ceases to be held for sale. So now you have two amounts. First amount is carrying amount when it was held for sale, just before application, and minus the depreciation etc. for the future period. So you'll get one amount as on today. Next, recoverable amount as on the date of seizure as on today. Compare that, take lower of that, and that is the amount at with that non-current asset which ceases to be held for sale will be shown, and later on regular accounting under the regular Ind AS 16, 36, 38, etc. will happen. So it will no more be held for sale. Okay. Now, this, when we do this adjustments, let us say asset is shown in our books at 4500, but because of this adjustment we have to show it at 4400, so there's a loss of 100. Whatever adjustments we do in the carrying amount because of this will go to P&L from continuing operation and will be shown accordingly. Okay, now sometimes it can happen that there's a disposal group which is held for sale, which has 5 assets which are the disposal group which is held for sale. Out of that one asset, now we intended that we won't sell it, we won't consider as a part of disposal group. So there were total 5 assets which was disposal group held for sale, which was measured as per 105. Now out of that one asset, we think now that is not a part of disposal group, we are not going to sell. So what to do of that asset? If an asset ceases to be a part of disposal group, then also same thing for that individual non-current asset which ceases to be part of disposal group, you will measure at carrying amount just before application of 105 minus the future depreciation till date, or recoverable amount till date, means the date on which it ceases, which is lower. At that amount, that individual non-current asset which is no more a part of disposal group will be measured, and accordingly whatever will be the differences, that gain or loss will go to P&L as gain or loss from continuing operation. Okay. Now, so these are the few paragraph which I just considered. This paragraph is considered, this paragraph is considered, then this one paragraph I leave it for some time and then I go to the next paragraph. Okay. The next paragraph is like this, that let us say there's a disposal group. Now, few assets and liabilities of the disposal group are no more part of disposal group. Then, if few assets and liabilities of disposal group are no more part of disposal group and that disposal group continues, then what? Then that's very simple, just we studied. If that few assets and liabilities are no more part of disposal group and that disposal group continues, the assets and liabilities which are no more part of disposal group are no more held for sale now. So it won't be shown as held for sale. Further, out of that, those non-current assets which are within the measurement scope of the standard and they are no more the part of disposal group, they are removed from the disposal group, they will be measured as per this above paragraph only. That is carrying amount just before it was held for sale minus the future depreciation or recoverable amount the date it ceases to be held for sale, which is lower, and whatever is difference, that will go to P&L as profit and loss for continuing operation. So I explain this in the form of some simple diagrams over there. You can observe. I'm just quickly repeat that part one second. Oh, hold on. Let me just get that diagrams on the board. This is the diagram. First is, there's a non-current asset which is ceases to be held for sale individually. So it will no more be shown as held for sale, plus it will be measured at lower of carrying amount before it is held for sale minus the depreciation, etc., for the future period till date, recoverable amount on the date it which ceases, which is lower, and then the gain or loss will be going to gain or loss from continuing operation. However, there's a disposal group and asset is and liability is not a part of disposal group anymore, but the remaining disposal group continues as a disposal group held for sale, then the assets and liabilities which ceases to be held for sale, they won't be shown as held for sale anymore. Plus, out of that non-current asset which ceases to be part of disposal group will be measured as per above. What will happen to, sir, other assets and liabilities which are not within the measurement scope of the standard? They will be measured as per respective index and they will no more be shown as held for sale. So what happens, you know, whenever earlier non-current asset or disposal group was held for sale, it was shown separately as held for sale. Now, when it ceases to be held for sale, it will no more be sold as held for sale, plus it will be the non-current asset which are within the measurement scope of the standard will be measured as per this point, and those assets and liabilities which are not as per the measurement scope of the standard will be measured as per their respective point. So what will happen to disposal group now? The remaining disposal group continues. Since the remaining disposal group continues to be held for sale, that remaining disposal group which continues to be held for sale will be measured as held for sale normal, considering that remaining disposal group, considering the remaining assets and liabilities in that group. Okay. Sir, what will happen if, let us say, there's a disposal group and that disposal group no more meets the definition of disposal group held for sale? Disposal group itself is broken down. Earlier what happened, there were disposal group, only some assets and liabilities of that disposal group were removed. Still the disposal group was still held for sale. Let us say now what happens is, there's a disposal group which has the assets and liabilities and that disposal group no more meets the definition of disposal group held for sale. That disposal group is only broken. Then what to do? Then divide into 3 parts. Those assets, those non-current assets which are within the measurement scope of the standard but still they are held for sale. So those non-current assets which are within the measurement scope of the standard and still they are held for sale, they will be continued as held for sale and normal held for sale for individual non-current asset, that measurement will be applicable means they will be measured at carrying amount of fair value less cost of disposal, which is a normal non-current asset held for sale. Accounting will be applicable for them. And they will continue. What will happen to those non-current assets to which the measurement scope of the standard is applicable, but they are no more held for sale? They cease to be held for sale. If they cease to be held for sale, then cease to be held for sale. That para 26 accounting, which is there for cease to be held for sale, that will be applicable. Means they will be measured at carrying amount before they were held for sale minus depreciation for the future period, or recoverable amount on the date of seizure, which is lower, and then gain or loss will be gain or loss from continuing operation, which will go to P&L. Okay, and then what will happen to other assets and liabilities? They will be measured as per their respective Ind AS, which are not within the measurement scope of the standard. Okay, and accordingly this change in plan to sell entire thing is given. Now there's one single paragraph remaining in that change in plan to sell. That is, let us say there's a subsidiary which was considered as held for sale. Now when a subsidiary was considered as held for sale, in my consolidated financial statements, the assets and liabilities of subsidiary are shown as held for sale separately. Now that subsidiary which was considered as held for sale, now it ceases to be classified as held for sale. So there was a subsidiary earlier which was considered as held for sale. So in my consolidated financial statement, the assets and liabilities of subsidiary were shown separately as held for sale assets and liabilities. Now today that subsidiary ceases to be held for sale, then they say all the financial statements from the date it was earlier classified as held for sale should be amended, and accordingly it should be presented. So financial statements for the period since the classification for held for sale should be amended and accordingly presented, as if it was never held for sale only, and then we have to give that represented. So amended from the date it was held for sale. So what I feel, because of this there can be a bigger impact and you might have to give a lot of things over there. So that was a rare case where everything in the past will be changed. Normally what happens if it was, say, the asset was held for sale and later on it ceases to be held for sale, it just accounted like a normal change in estimate, and prospectively we change the amount and go out in future. Past amounts are not adjusted. But over here, when there is a subsidiary which is held for sale and now it is no more held for sale, all the past financial statements will also be amended as if it was never held for sale. Okay, so that's a quite different point over there. Now that's all about that non-current asset or disposal group, and that I have taught you what do you mean by non-current asset and disposal group held for sale, how do you measure it, how do you reverse it, what will happen if there's a change in plan to sell. But I am yet to talk about the presentation and disclosure of that non-current asset or disposal group held for sale, and that is also quite important. Okay, so now what to do of that non-current asset or disposal group which is classified for held for sale from presentation and disclosure point of view. Presentation and disclosure should be such that it enables the users of the financial statements to evaluate the effect. Now how you can present it? So they say the non-current asset which is held for sale and all the assets of the disposal group which is held for sale, that should be separately presented from other assets in the balance sheet. So let us say there is a balance sheet. Then non-current asset which is held for sale or assets, all the assets of disposal group which is held for sale, that should be shown separately in the balance sheet, separately from current non-current, as a separate line item, assets which are held for sale. Similarly in the liabilities also, all the liabilities which are part of disposal group which is held for sale should be shown as a separate liability other than that non-current liability, separately as liabilities held for sale. Now you are not allowed to offset the assets and liabilities. Assets will be shown separately as assets held for sale, liability will be shown separately as liabilities held for sale. You are not allowed to offset the assets and liabilities. Okay, further, when the assets and liabilities are shown, in that assets and liabilities, major class of assets or major class of liabilities which is held for sale should also be disclosed either in the balance sheet or in the notes. Let us say there are 10 assets which is held for sale, so I will show separately in my balance sheet on the asset side assets held for sale. Now out of that 10 assets, some might be inventory, some might be fixed asset, so the major classes of asset held for sale should be shown separately either in the balance sheet or in the notes. Same way, the major class of liabilities which is held for sale should be shown separately either in the balance sheet or notes accounts. Okay, further, whatever amount regarding that assets are there in the other comprehensive income part in that equity, other equity, that should also be shown separately. Example, let us say there is a PP which is held for sale, so that is shown separately as asset held for sale. Now there is a revaluation reserve regarding that PP. Now where that revaluation reserve regarding that PP will be shown? So it will be shown in the balance sheet on the equities and liabilities side as other equity, that revaluation reserve accumulated as a part of OCI. So whatever cumulative income or loss is there in OCI regarding those non-current asset or disposal group which is held for sale, that amount should be shown separately in OCI. Means you will be showing equities and liabilities in that equity share capital, and then other equities in that, you will show separately amount in OCI which represents cumulatively income or loss regarding those non-current assets or disposal group held for sale. Okay, so how it will be shown? So I will show, just quickly show you So this is my balance sheet. So in my balance sheet, assets, in my assets, current, non-current, then held for sale separately. In my liabilities, equities and liabilities, in equity, though that amount in other comprehensive income which relates to non-current asset or disposal group held for sale will be shown separately. Then in my liability side, after my non-current liabilities and current liabilities, liabilities which are part of disposal group which is held for sale, which will be shown separately. And then the details of that assets liability will also be given either over here or in notes to account. So in the insured, they say we'll be showing in notes accounts, but you can show it over there also, or you can show it in the notes accounts also. Okay, that option is available. Okay, now there's one exception over here, that let us say there's a newly acquired subsidiary, and that newly acquired subsidiary is considered as held for sale from the date of acquisition itself. So that can happen in their case. If there's a newly acquired subsidiary and that newly acquired subsidiary is considered as held for sale from the date of acquisition only, then what will happen in my consolidated financial statements? The assets and liabilities of that subsidiary will be shown separately as held for sale. The only relaxation available over here is you need not disclose a major class within that assets and liabilities. Description need not be given. Obviously, the assets and liabilities will have to be shown separately. Assets will have to be shown separately as held for sale. Liabilities will have to be shown as separately as held for sale. The only relaxation available for newly acquired subsidiary which is considered as held for sale from the date of acquisition itself is that the internal bifurcation of the major classes of assets and liabilities are not required. Okay, now very important point, next one. The comparative figures for that non-current assets and liabilities which is held for sale or disposal group which is held for sale in the balance sheet for the prior periods are not reclassified. Means, let us say if a non-current asset is held for sale or if a disposal group is held for sale from the current year, then in the current year it is shown as separately held for sale. The earlier periods, earlier years figures are not reclassified and they are not shown separately. Means, if let us say if a non-current asset is held for sale or disposal group is held for sale and is considered as held for sale in 2-3, then 1-2 figures are not reclassified. 1-2, where it was there, it will be shown there only. Okay, and accordingly I have changed something in the insured module. You can note that accordingly, because I feel that's a mistake. And now that's a proper presentation, that in 2-3, if it is becomes held for sale and shown separately, 1-2 figures are not required to be reclassified. And this is the reason why I feel that normally when a non-current asset or disposal group is held for sale, normally you need not give that classification adjustments of three balance sheets, etc. You just need to show that in the current year figure when it happens in the current year. Last year figures are also not represented when a non-current asset or disposal group is held for sale. So remember everyone, when a non-current asset or disposal group is held for sale, the assets and liabilities on the current period when it is held for sale are shown separately. However, the previous year figures are not reclassified and not represented. Clear? The only exception is when, what happens is, let us say if there's a subsidiary which is considered as held for sale and later on it ceases to be held for sale, then it is amended from the very beginning. That's the only exception. Rest all cases, what I feel is last year figures are not amended. Are you getting it? Next. Whatever gain or loss is there because of that remeasurement of that non-current asset or disposal group. See, whenever the non-current asset or disposal group is considered as held for sale, so there will be certain gain or loss because we measure it at fair value less cost of disposal. And that gain or loss, second effect will go to P&L. So in P&L, it will normally go to gain or loss from continuing operation. Unless that disposal group is considered as discontinued operation. So normally when there is a gain or loss because of that measuring that non-current asset or disposal group at fair value less cost to sell, that gain or loss will normally go to P&L as profit and loss from continuing operation. Exception is that disposal group itself is considered as a discontinued operation, then only it will be shown as profit and loss from discontinued operation. So I can explain you that part with the help of this part. Let us say I put up a laptop on sale. If I put up a laptop on sale, it's a normal individual non-current asset which is held for sale. So what we'll be doing is, it will be measuring at carrying amount of fair value less cost of disposal, which is lower, and accordingly gain or loss will be that gain or loss will go to normal P&L from continuing operation. Second example, let us say my operations continue, no operation is shut down, but I put laptop and my internet connection equipments which I'm using for this lectures as held for sale together, but my business continues as normal. I bought new laptop and new internet connection equipments which I'll be using in my business, so my business continues, my operation continues only. I've just put a laptop and an internet connection equipment for sale together, so it's like a disposal group held for sale. But the disposal group held for sale cannot be considered as discontinued operation because my operations still continue only. In that case, the gain or loss which will happen, because you will measure, since a disposal group is held for sale, you will measure that disposal group at carrying amount of fair value less cost of disposal, which is lower, and there can be gain or loss. That gain or loss will go to P&L as P&L from continuing operation. Third example, Let us say, I have two operations. This is one CA coaching, another is CA practice. Let us say, I decide to discontinue CA practice and I put up all the assets and liabilities of that operation for sale together. So it's a disposal group held for sale and also it's a discontinued operation also. I have discontinued a particular operation altogether. In that case, when we measure it at carrying amount of fair value less cost of disposal, which is low, and there is a gain or loss, this gain or loss will go to P&L as gain or loss from discontinued operation. And this is what is explained over here in this last paragraph, and that creates a base for our next part. Okay, then there are certain disclosure requirements for that non-current asset or disposal group held for sale. What are the disclosure requirements for non-current asset or disposal group which was held for sale? You need to give description about them. You need to in your disclosures, you have to give that description in the notes to financial statements, in the notes to accounts. You have to give that description. These are the non-current asset or disposal group which is held for sale. You have to give the facts and circumstances if it is already sold regarding saying, and if it is expected to be sold, then facts and circumstances regarding expected manner and timing of disposal should be disclosed over there. Then whatever gain or loss is there, that should be disclosed. And what happens is, whenever a non-current asset or disposal group is held for sale, that gain or loss goes to P&L either as a part of continuing or discontinued operation. If it is shown as a separate line item, no problem. If it is not shown as a separate line item, then in your notes to accounts, you will have to disclose that that gain or loss is hidden in this point, other income, etc. Where it is hidden, you need to give that. Okay. Next, if that non-current asset or disposal group is a part of any reportable segment, operating segment, then you need to discuss, this is the non-current asset or disposal group, it's a part of this segment which we have shown, if it is possible as per Ind AS 108. Okay, if there's a change in plan to sell, we have to disclose about the facts and circumstances regarding the same. So now I'm completely done with non-current asset held for sale and disposal group held for sale. Now we go to the next part of this Ind AS. Next part of this Ind AS is discontinued operation. Now what do you mean by discontinued operation? Discontinued operation, it should be a component of an entity which is either disposed or which is held for sale. So if there is a component of entity which is either disposed of, which is held for sale, then I can say it's a discontinued operation, and there are other conditions also, but that's a base. So if a component of entity is either disposed or it is classified as held for sale, it is known as discontinued operation. So what do you mean by component of an entity? Component of an entity means it's an operation, it's a cash flows which can be distinguished, clearly distinguished operationally and for financial reporting purpose also from the rest of the entity. When you are able to distinguish operationally and financial reporting purpose certain operations and cash flows, I can say it's a component of an entity. Example, let us say I have a CA practice and CA coaching. From CA practice, whatever operations or cash flows are happen, I can distinguish them operationally and financial reporting purpose from other part of my entity. Yes, I can do that. Then I can say that CA practice is a component of an entity. Okay, let us say I have three things, CA foundation, CA inter and CA final, but I'm not able to distinguish cash flows and operations operationally and for financial reporting purpose of CA foundation from CA final, then I cannot say they are different components. Together they will be considered as a single component. Are you getting it? So very important to be considered as discontinued operations. It should be a component of entity which is either disposed or classified as held for sale, and component of entity means it can be distinguished operationally and financial reporting purpose from the rest of the entity. Now, further, that component of entity should represent separate major line of business or geographical area of operation. So, when that component represents separate major line of business or geographical area of operation, I can say it's a discontinued operation. Or that component represents a single coordinated plan to dispose that separate major line of business or geographical area of operation. Means somewhere that component should represent that we are trying to dispose of a separate major line of business or geographical area of operation, then only we can say it's a discontinued operation. Let us have 200 branches of 200 branches of fast food shop in Delhi. One of the branch only I discontinue, that's it. Now it cannot be said as a major line of business or geographical area because rest branches continue. Okay, so you need to know that component should represent some major line of business or geographical area, or it should be a part of plan to dispose that major line of geographical area of business of operation. Okay, or it can be a subsidiary which can be acquired with the view of resale. When you when there is a subsidiary which is just acquired with the purpose of resale, then we can say it can be considered as a discontinued operation because it's a component also and it satisfies this condition also. So either A, B, C, one of them should at least be satisfied to be considered over there. Okay, now accordingly the examples are given. So what happens if it is considered as a discontinued operation? Once it is considered as discontinued operation, fulfills the definition of discontinued operation as per Ind AS 105, then what to do? Then in P&L, a single amount should be presented as a separate line item, which consists of profit and loss from the discontinued operation and profit and loss from measuring at fair value less cost of disposal that disposal group is a part of that discontinued operation, and single amount, and that should be a post-tax amount. So let us say I have decided to discontinue my CA practice in the current year 17-18. So whatever is the profit or loss, post-tax profit or loss from that CA practice, I need to find out that. Plus, since that CA practice is now held for sale, it's a disposal group which is held for sale, it will be measured at fair value less cost of sale. So there can be gain or loss on that measurement also. That gain also or loss, we have to measure it as post-tax basis. We have to add that all amounts and show it in P&L on the face of P&L as a separate line item. Profit or post-tax profit or loss from discontinued operation, that will be the ultimate outer column amount. Okay, so whenever you have a discontinued operation, post-tax profit and loss from the discontinued operation plus post-tax gain or loss from remeasurements to fair value less cost of sale, that all amount should be clubbed together and a single amount should be shown on the face of the P&L as a total outer column or the total amount. Now what about the bifurcation? Then later on you need to bifurcate that single amount into four parts: normal revenue, expense, pre-tax profit from the discontinued operation and tax on that. Example, CA practice. So normally revenue, expense, pre-tax profit of that CA operation and the tax on that. Second, gain or loss on remeasurement to fair value less cost to sell. So whatever assets and liabilities of the CA practice are there, I will be measuring at fair value less cost to sell. So there can be gain or loss and tax on that gain or loss. This four amount should be bifurcated and given. So where this bifurcation can be given? This bifurcation can be given either on the face of P&L or on the notes to accounts, and accordingly you will measure the P&L. Okay, so in P&L outer column we know what amount, then bifurcation either can be given in P&L or in notes to accounts. No. Further, profit and loss from continuing operation should be shown separately, profit and loss from discontinuing operation should be shown separately. However, if there's a newly acquired subsidiary and that newly acquired subsidiary is held for sale from the date of acquisition itself only, then in that case this ABCD bifurcation is not required. Rest, you have to show it as a discontinued operation separately only, profit and loss from that subsidiary. Okay. Next, whatever profit is there from continuing operation and whatever profit is there from discontinued operation, later on you need to bifurcate how much of this belongs to owner, how much of this belongs to NCI. So you need to give the bifurcation. Profit and loss from the continuing operation should also be bifurcated for owners and NCI, and profit and loss from discontinued operation should also be bifurcated for owners and NCI in the statement of P&L. In the cash flow statement, what you need to give? Cash flows which are attributable, operating cash flows, investing cash flows, financing cash flows regarding discontinued operation should be shown separately. So if there's a discontinued operation, then whatever cash flows are there in operating, financing, investing activities regarding that discontinued operation should be shown separately. So if my CA practice is my discontinued operation, whatever cash flows of that CA practice are there in my operating, investing, finance, I'll be showing it separately. Further, there's another paragraph which is a totally different paragraph, not related to cash flow, it's related to financial statement as a whole. They say that whenever there's a discontinued operation, that discontinued operation figures are presented separately in P&L. That though we know, the profit and loss from that discontinued operation are presented separately in P&L. Now in that case, let us say if the operation is discontinued in a particular year, let us say 17-18, then in our P&L in 17-18 will be showing continuing separately and discontinued separately, and that figures of discontinuing will be shown separately. Further, 16-17 P&L which we show in 17-18 accounts, when we present, we present current year and the previous year. So in the current year though, it will be shown separately. Further, 16-17 figure which are presented in 17-18 accounts, 16-17 figures which are presented in 17-18 accounts, in that P&L it will be restated and shown as profit and loss from discontinuing operation as a separate line item. From that, shareholders will able to know that yes, this operation is discontinued from the current year only, but whatever profit is earned from the discontinued operation in the current year, previous year, that is shown separately, so that the shareholders are able to measure the future maintainable profits easily, what will be there from the continuing operation easily. So I repeat, if a operation is discontinued in 17-18, then while making 17-18 accounts, in the 17-18 column, the profit and loss from the discontinued operation will be shown separately in P&L. Further, in the 16-17 column also, which is there in 17-18 accounts, previous year, in that also the profit and loss from that discontinuing operation will be shown separately. Only P&L figures are restated, no assets and liabilities of earlier years are restated, only the P&L for that 2 years are restated, and that to P&L figures, no assets and liabilities are figure, and therefore opening balance sheet at the beginning of the previous year is not required, because balance sheet figures, assets and liabilities figures are never adjusted. Only P&L of the last year is, and that to the restated means just a bifurcation is given. Earlier we already would have given total figure of profit and loss in the last year. Only in this year it is bifurcated as continuing and discontinuing, nothing else. Total amount is just bifurcated in P&L. Assets and liabilities figures are not changed for them. And accordingly, opening balance sheet of the previous years are not required. However, in the balance sheet, whatever are held for sale assets and liabilities are shown separately only in the current year figures and not in the previous year figures. So you need to remember that when a non-current asset is held for sale or disposal group is held for sale figures in the balance sheet are shown separately in the balance sheet in the current year column only, previous years are not registered. Whereas in P&L for discontinued operation, the profit and loss from the discontinued operation is shown separately in the current year column also and the previous year column also. In all the cases, opening of the previous year is not required over here, neither in case of non-current asset disposal group held for sale nor in case of discontinued operation. Opening of the preceding year balance sheet is not required over there. So I hope everyone is clear, and that is sir's interpretation, my interpretation. I am very sure on that. I repeat, if there is a non-current asset or disposal group which is held for sale, which we considered earlier, so in the balance sheet we have to present it separately in the current year when it happens. Earlier years profits, earlier figures of assets and liabilities are not registered. But when there is a discontinued operation, then in the P&L, profit and loss from the discontinued operation is shown current year in the current year column also, in the previous year column also. In balance sheet, whatever is the part of the disposal group which is held for sale, in the current year only, the assets and liabilities will be shown in the separately in the current year column, not in the previous year column. So this is a presentation in the balance sheet and P&L, and that is a very important point. Next, certain times it can happen that if a operation is a discontinued operation in 17-18, so while making P&L of 17-18, it will be shown separately, and in that 16-17 column will also be restated. Let us say we go ahead now, 17-18, that all operation is already disposed of, discontinued operation, let us assume it is also sold. Now in 18-19, what will happen? In 18-19 we'll have two columns, 18-19 and 17-18. Now 18-19, my CA practice is already closed, so there will be no generally profit and loss on that CA practice at all. However, there can be certain change in estimates which can arise regarding that discontinued operation. So if there is a change in estimate which arises regarding the discontinued operation, so it should be shown as discontinued operation only. Example, CA practice had closed in 17-18, so it's shown that as discontinued operation in 17-18 accounts, in 17-18 and 16-17 column. Now in 18-19 there is no cash flows of no gain or loss from CA practice, so in 18-19 generally there is no other figure. 17-18 figure in 18-19 accordingly there will be discontinued operation figures which is there earlier. But in 18-19 what happens is, let us say earlier some employee benefit expense which I had estimated and put up as discontinued operation as expense, but now estimates are changed and extra 1 lakh is payable in 18-19, and that's a change in estimate. So this loss of change in estimate will be accounted in 18-19 as profit and loss from discontinued operation, because it relates to CA practice which is discontinued, and that is given in this adjustment for prior period. Okay, now sometimes when there's a discontinued operation, there can be change in plan to sell, means now it is no more a discontinued operation. In that case, all the P&Ls which are presented in the current period, current year accounts, whatever current things are presented in the current year accounts, current year, last year, in that P&L it will be just be represented, nothing else. Same is the case with loss of control in the subsidiary, nothing else. So that paragraph are just one each paragraph. Presentation of P&L is given for discontinued operation, that whenever there is a discontinued operation, you will be showing continuing separately, discontinuing separately. In fact, last year is also restated in P&L and given accordingly. And then accordingly, the bifurcations are given, that what is for owner, what is for NCI. And then further bifurcations are also given in notes or either on the face of P&L. And then we have distinguish over there. Distinguish between Ind AS 105 over here and AS 24 earlier. The first distinguish is, when we see Ind AS 105, it's non-accounting for non-current asset which are held for sale, and also presentation and disclosure for discontinued operation. AS 24 was quite different earlier. In AS, it was just about reporting of discontinuing operation. It never talked about assets held for sale, etc. However, AS 10 talked about PP held for sale, but AS 24 never did that. Next, distinguish between AS and Ind AS over there is, in AS what they told us, if a cash flow statement is there, then requirements of cash flow regarding the discontinued operation given in AS 24 is applicable. In AS, no, cash flow is AS 3. So AS 3 is not applicable to all entities, it depends upon the applicability criteria. So let us say if there's an entity to which AS3, that cash flow is not applicable, in that case, in case of discontinued operation of AS24, the requirements of cash flow will not be applicable. And if that there's an entity to which AS3 cash flow is applicable, then the requirements of cash flow for AS24, that will be applicable. That is AS special, because in AS separately for AS3 applicability is also there. But in AS, there's no separate applicability. If Ind AS is applicable to you, all Ind AS is applicable, or no Ind AS is applicable. If Ind AS is applicable, you have to make cash flows. That's it. So there's no such point in Ind AS. Next, in AS, we use the word discontinuing operation. In Ind AS, we use discontinued operation. So AS, the word was discontinuing operation. Ind AS, the word is discontinued operation. And what do you mean by discontinued operation as per Ind AS, which I have studied? Either the component which is disposed or held for sale, that is discontinued operation. So that's quite difference in the definition over there and the wordings over there. Next, time period. In Ind AS, to be considered as held for sale, there's a time period that when we classify as held for sale, the sale should be expected to be completed within 1 year. There are certain exceptions, obviously, but there's some time period in Ind AS. There's no such time period in AS for discontinuing operation. Now, in AS, now the word is discontinuing operation. So that operation is considered as discontinuing AS. In Ind AS, so we had discontinued. Okay. So in AS, there's a word discontinuing. So it should be considered as discontinuing from a one particular date, and that date is initial disclosure event. So in AS, initial disclosure event is a word that is defined and that is there in AS, because from that date, it will be discontinuing. But in Ind AS, we don't require that word, because the word used in Ind AS is discontinued operation. So there's no word like initial disclosure event in Ind AS. So AS has a word initial disclosure event, which is defined in AS. Ind AS does not have such words. Okay. Next, measurement. In case of Ind AS, now what happens is when there's a non-current asset or disposal group which is held for sale, we measure it at carrying amount or fair value less cost of disposal, which is lower in the balance sheet. Okay. In AS 24 is silent, but there's AS 10 on that. And AS 10 talks about a PPE which is held for sale. So it is measured at net book value or net realizable value, which is lower. So in AS, book value, realizable value words are used. In Ind AS, carrying amount, fair value less cost of disposal, that words are used. And you should know that fair value is quite different from net realizable value, because fair value is market based and net realizable value is entity based. Okay, next, abandonment of asset. Okay, so that's a quite different point. In Ind AS, we just studied that abandonment of asset cannot be considered as held for sale, because it later on it can be used. We have not thrown away that asset, it is just kept aside. We are not temporary using, we might use it in future. So in Ind AS, we had studied that abandonment of asset may not be considered as held for sale. Okay, in AS, that's a total different thing. When you in AS, that it says that normally abandonment of asset does not consider abandonment of assets can be classified as held for can be classified as discontinuing operation in AS. However, if there's only a change in scope or manner, then it is not considered as abandoned and not a discontinuing operation. So these two points are totally different. In Ind AS, we studied that abandonment of asset cannot be considered as held for sale. In AS, they say that when there's an abandonment, it can be considered as a discontinuing operation. However, if there's only a change in scope or manner, then it cannot be considered as abandonment, and then it cannot be considered as a discontinuing operation. So that's a quite different point in AS and Ind AS. Now, in Ind AS, we have a guidance regarding change in plan to sell. So we had studied that change in plan to sell. In AS, there's no such guidance. Now, in AS and Ind AS, there's a difference in the definition of discontinued and discontinuing. In Ind AS, we studied that discontinued operation is a component which represents separate major line of business or geographical area or subsidiary acquired with the view of resale, etc. There's a definition of discontinued operation in Ind AS. In AS, discontinuing operation is accordingly defined. There's few wordings, difference in wordings, nothing else over there. That's it. So we are done with a very quick revision of Ind AS 105, non-current asset held for sale, and discontinued operations. Okay. Thank you. Quickly like, comment, share if you have liked this. Okay. Let us now do quick revision of Ind AS 37, provisions, contingent liabilities, and contingent asset. Okay, now the related AS was AS 29 at your lower levels. Now you have Ind AS 37 on the same. So what is the objective of this Ind AS? We will be studying about recognition, measurement, disclosures about this provisions, contingent liabilities, and contingent assets, so that it enables users to clearly know the nature, timing and amount of that provisions, contingent liabilities and contingent asset. It will help the users. Okay. Now, what's the scope of this standard? We'll be studying accounting for the provisions, contingent liabilities, contingent asset, except certain things. Certain things are not the part of this Ind AS. What are not the part of Ind AS? Executory contracts. Executory contracts are not part of this Ind AS. They will not be accounted. Example of executory contract is both the parties are yet to perform their obligation, or both the parties have partially performed their obligation only to the equal extent, then it is known as executory contract for the remaining part. I have promised I will buy the goods from you, and you have told that you will sell the goods to me, and I'll make the payment. I have not yet made the payment, you have not sold the goods, both the obligations are still pending. It is known as executory contract, and executory contract are not considered in Ind AS 37. However, if this executory contract becomes onerous, then it is covered in Ind AS 37. So what do you mean by an onerous contract? Onerous contract means the cost of meeting, the unavoidable cost of meeting the contract, meeting the obligation, exceeds the benefit to be derived, then it is known as onerous contract. Example, I have promised that I will buy 10,000 units of product from you at the rate 45 per unit. Okay, and you have promised to sell me in future. So I am yet to buy, I am yet to make the payment, you are yet to sell. It's an executory contract till now. Now what happens is I was going to buy that raw material from you, and that I was going to use in my business. Now that business I am no more going to continue. I have discontinued that business. But I have entered into contract with you, and that contract is an enforceable contract. Contract is a binding contract, and if I don't follow that contract, if there's a breach of contract, then there will be damages. Then I analyze the contract. Now I have to buy the raw materials from you because I have entered into an enforceable contract with you. If I buy the raw material, I will have to buy at, let us say, 45 per unit, 10,000 units, and let us say I can sell in the market only at 40 per unit. So there will be 5 per unit loss, and there are 10,000 units which I will have to buy. So there's a loss of 50,000 which can happen. I won't be able to use that product, I'll just scrap off in the market. Then I see what will happen if I don't honor the contract. Then I'll have to pay damages to you, and let us assume the damages in the contract is 60,000. So what I'll choose? I'll either choose that loss or damage which is lower. So loss or damage which is lower is the amount which is provided for onerous contract. 50,000 is the loss which if I honor the contract, and 60,000 is the loss if I don't honor the contract. In any case, there's going to be a loss, so I will choose lower of them, and that 50,000 I will have to provide now when the contract becomes onerous. Now when the contract becomes onerous, when that event happens, when I discontinue that business, etc., I have to provide for that onerous contract. So conclusion is, executory contracts are out of the scope of the standard, but onerous contracts are within the scope of the standard. And onerous contract, you have to provide, a provision has to be made when the contract becomes onerous. So let us say discontinuance of a particular line of business makes the contract onerous, so you have to provide when that discontinuance happens. Okay. Next, financial instruments. Financial instruments including guarantees are out of this Ind AS because they are covered in 109. So everyone remember guarantee, which earlier at your lower levels you were considering as a contingent liability. It's a contingent liability, but it is out of scope of Ind AS 37. It is covered in 109. So financial instruments and guarantees are covered in 109. Next, if anything is specifically covered, if any provision, contingent liability, contingent asset, if anything of that is specifically covered in any other standard, then it won't be covered over here. Example, certain contingencies are already covered in Ind AS 115, so that is not covered over here. However, if the contract becomes onerous, then it is covered over here in Ind AS 37. Because Ind AS 115 does not talk about onerous contract. So everyone remember, if there are certain things which is already covered in 115, then it won't be covered over here again. But Ind AS 115 specifically does not deal with onerous contract. So onerous contract will be dealt over here in Ind AS 37 only. Next, income taxes. They are not covered over here. Income taxes are covered in Ind AS 12 income taxes. Now leases. Leases are covered in Ind AS 116 leases. However, if before the commencement date of the lease, there is something as inception date of the lease, there is something as commencement date of the lease, that you understand once you study 116. However, before commencement date of the lease, if the lease become onerous, then that onerous part will be covered over here. Onerous contract will be covered over here. So normally leases are covered in 116, so they are covered over their entire provision. But before the commencement date, if the lease becomes onerous, then it is covered over here in Ind AS 37. Next, there are two types of lease. There is short-term lease and lease of low value assets. Short-term lease and lease of low value asset. Now they are accounted in a different manner over there in Ind AS 116. So in case of short-term lease and leases of low value asset, if you have taken up that option of different manner of accounting in 116, that you will study in 116. In that case, that short-term lease or lease of low value, they become onerous any time it will be covered over here in 37. So normal lease will covered in 37 only if they become onerous before the commencement date. But short term leases and lease of low value which have a special accounting in 116, where you follow a special accounting in 116, that contracts, they become onerous any time that will be covered in 37. They become onerous, you come over here, also you follow 116. Okay, next. Employee benefit liabilities, etc. Employee benefit things, there is already a standard Ind AS 19 covered over there, so not covered in 37. Insurance contract, there can be certain provisions, contingent liabilities regarding insurance contract, so 104 is applicable. But an insurance company can have other provisions, contingent liability, contingent asset other than those arising from insurance contract also. They can have your normal business also. I am an insurance company, I have to pay auditor fees. They can have other provisions, contingent liabilities, contingent asset that will be accounted as per Ind AS 137 only. Only those things which arise from insurance contract, that is covered in 104. Other than that, everything will be covered in 37 for them. Okay, next. If there is a contingent consideration in business combination, there is a very specific case, contingent consideration in business combination, that you will study in 103, not over here, even if it is contingent. Okay, so that was the scope of the standard. Then we go ahead with the next one, executory contract. I have already done. Neither parties have, in one case it is like neither of the parties have performed any of their obligation, or in another case that both the parties have only equally performed that obligation. So balance part is pending, that is known as executory contract. Executory contract are not part of Ind AS 37 unless they become onerous. Next. So many a times it happens that provisions are many a times adjusted from the carrying amount of the asset, like provision for doubtful debt, provision for depreciation. They say those provisions which are adjusted from the carrying amount of the asset, means subtracted from the carrying amount of the asset, they are not covered by the standard. They will be covered in their respective standard only. Okay, so provision for depreciation 16, etc., you will be following that. Next. Next is this provision for restructuring also. So provision for restructuring, yes, provision for restructuring, this standard is applicable. What is that provision for restructuring? We'll study that later in this lecture only. Now, certain definitions regarding liability and provisions. First definition, you have to study about liability basically always. Liability means there should be a present obligation because of a past event, the settlement of which is going to result in outflow of economic resources, then it will say it is a liability. Example, I have purchased a goods. If I have purchased a goods and the payment is pending, it's a present obligation because of a past event known as purchase of goods, and the settlement of which is going to result in outflow of economic resources. So that's a liability. So very important, liability should have both the present obligation and that too due to past event. Obviously, there should be outflow of economic resources also. That past event is known as the obligating event. So always because of a past obligating event, if you have a present obligation, it's a liability. Present obligation means you have to pay, no other option. You have to pay. Clear? Now, when you go to provision, what happens is provision is also a form of liability only. Provision is also a type of liability only. The only difference is there either amount or timing is uncertain. If the amount or timing is uncertain, we say it's a provision. Clear? Now, so can I say like this, be it provision or be it liability, it should be because of a past event, the obligating event. Now that past obligating event which gives rise to provision or liability, that's very important. If that past obligating event is not there, there is no provision, no liability. Now that past obligating event which gives rise to either provision or liability can be a legal obligation or a constructive obligation also. That obligating event can be a legal obligation also, or that obligating event can be a constructive obligation also. Now, that to be a legal obligation means it derives either from contract or legislation or law. So let us say I have entered into contract with you, okay, where I have bought the goods and I am liable to pay. So that's a legal obligation arising from a contract. Clear? Next, sometimes there can be constructive obligation also. Now, constructive obligation arises from actions, past practices, published policies, specific statements made. So constructive obligation is more from our actions, where because of past practices, policies, statements made, entity has accepted certain responsibilities and that has created a valid expectation in the mind of other persons that entity is going to discharge that responsibilities. Then it is known as constructive obligation. Example, there was an entity which was polluting an environment and there was no law requiring restoration, etc. There was no legal obligation, nothing. But one fine day, the local people over there staged a protest. And therefore, entity told them, okay, kindly disperse, don't do protesting over here. We will install pollution control equipments, etc. So there is no legal obligation, but there is a constructive obligation where entity has made a public statement and that has created a valid expectation in the mind of the other person that the entity will discharge that responsibility. That is a constructive obligation. In Ind AS, even a constructive obligation is provided. So that past event which creates a provision or a liability, that past event can be a legal obligation, that can be a constructive obligation also. Depends. It can be any of them. Clear? Next, I come over here, provision. I need to deliberate few extra points about provision. See, for a provision, now we conclude that for a provision is also a form of liability. So for a provision, we need a present obligation. It should be because of a past obligating event. There should be probable outflow of economic resources and it can be estimated. The best part of provision is it should be able to be estimated. Then only we say it's a provision. If all these points happen together, then it's a provision. So how you will decide whether there's a present obligation or not? Normally from the transaction, it is very simple and you clearly tell it's a present obligation or it's not a present obligation. Because present obligation means you have to pay. However, many a times there can be certain cases where it is very difficult to find whether there is a present obligation or not. Example, court case. In that case, whether there is a present obligation for that obligation, liability to pay that obligation or not, you have to check whether that obligation is more likely, whether that obligation is more probable. If that obligation is more likely, if that obligation is more probable, means more than 50% chance that you are required to pay that, then that's a present obligation. And if there's a present obligation because of a past obligating event which will result in outflow of economic resources, probable outflow of economic resources which can be estimated, then we'll be creating a provision. However, if that obligation is less likely, if that obligation is not probable, if that obligation is less than equal to 50% chance, then we can say it's only a possible obligation. It's not a present obligation. If it's a possible obligation, then not a provision. So what will happen then? If the conditions are not fulfilled, it goes to contingent liability. Example, if the obligation is not a present obligation, but just a possible obligation, means not probable, less than equal to 50% chance, then it's a possible obligation, then it is known as contingent liability. Sometimes it can happen that there's a present obligation, but the outflow of resources is not probable. Because for a provision, outflow of resources should also be probable. But let us say there is a present obligation, but outflow of resources is not probable. That can happen in rare cases. Example, let us say I had an obligation to teach extra 1 hour to one student because I had promised him. But there is no outflow of economic resources which is going to happen. I am going to take it on Sunday extra hour and there will be no other outflow of economic resources which is going to happen. That can happen in rare case. Then I can say it's a present obligation, but outflow of resources is not probable. Then I can say it's a contingent liability. Whatever example just I gave for the second part is a very crude example, just for your knowledge purpose. Example purpose, if there's a present obligation, but outflow of resources is not probable, then we can say it's a contingent liability. Clear? Then next, sometimes it can happen there's a present obligation, but it cannot be estimated reliably. If it cannot be estimated reliably, it's a contingent liability. So can I say like this, if the conditions of this provisions are not fulfilled, any one of them is also not fulfilled, it falls under contingent liability. For it to be a provision, there should be a present obligation also, because of past event also, probable outflow of economic resources should also be there and should be estimated. When all of them happen, it's a provision. If any one is violated, it's a possible obligation, contingent liability. It's a present obligation, but outflow is not probable, contingent liability. If there's a present obligation, but cannot be estimated, in rare cases, contingent liability. Are you getting it? So accordingly, contingent liability definition is given over there. It's a possible obligation. It depends upon happening, non-happening of future uncertain event not within the control of an enterprise. Example, someone has filed a case against me. It's not a present obligation. It's just a possible thing. Only 40% chances that I pay, less chances that I pay. It depends upon occurrence or non-occurrence of future uncertain event not within the control of an enterprise. It's a contingent liability. Or else it can be a present obligation with where outflow of resources is not probable, then contingent liability. Or if it's a present obligation but you cannot measure it reliably, contingent liability. So this is a definition of contingent liability. Are you getting it? Accordingly, we have considered the definition of provision also and contingent liability also, and also of the obligating event, which can be legal obligation or constructive obligation. Clear? Then next, what's a contingent asset? As we have a contingent liability, we have a contingent asset. Contingent asset means a possible asset. The existence of will be confirmed by occurrence, non-occurrence of future uncertain event not within the control of an enterprise. Example, I filed a legal suit against some person and I might receive something, then that's a possible asset which can be confirmed only by occurrence or non-occurrence of future uncertain event not within the control of an enterprise. So it's a contingent asset. Clear? Now, so what to do of a provision, liability, contingent asset? That I'll teach you as we go ahead. Should we provide or should we recognize it or not? How should we measure it? How should we disclose it? I'll tell you. But these are just the definitions. Next definition is of onerous contract. Onerous contract means unavoidable cost of meeting the obligation exceeds the economic benefit to be derived from that contract has become onerous contract. The day that contract become onerous contract, we need to provide that. So accordingly, we'll be considering that onerous contract. Executory contract are not a part of this Ind AS, but onerous contract are part of this Ind AS. Clear? Next. Restructuring is defined. We'll take up when that restructuring aspect comes. Next. There's a difference between provision and a liability. The difference between the provision and liability is provisions have uncertain amount, uncertain timing, either uncertain amount or uncertain timing. So there's high level of uncertainty in provision, and therefore they are known as provision, and that's a basic difference between provision and a liability. Obviously, liability also has some uncertainty, but not that much. So can I say like this? Provisions has much more uncertainty as compared to liability. Example, I have bought the goods and amount is payable. That is a liability, because what has happened? I have bought the goods. He might have billed also. Everything is accepted. I need to pay it. So that's a liability. Obviously, later on it can happen that that other person is not found and I'm not paying, or some amount gets changed because I request him, just give me the discount, etc. So liabilities have some small uncertainty, but not much. But since it is already billed, amount is already agreed, so more or less it is certain only. So liabilities are more certain, like creditors, and provisions are less certain, like provision for warranty, provision for guarantee. There's more uncertainty over there. Clear? That's how you compare the provisions and liabilities. Next paragraph is already done, that in provisions there is a present obligation. In contingent liability, either there is a possible obligation or there is a present obligation where you do not have probable outflow of economic resources, etc. So the next relationship between provisions and contingent liability is already done. Next, provisions, how should you recognize? So there are conditions to be fulfilled. Once you fulfill that condition, then only you can recognize a provision. Conditions are already done. There should be a present obligation because of a past event. Probable outflow of resources should be estimated over there, and reliable estimates can be made. When all of them happen together, then only provision can be recognized. So that is there in this slide. When there is a present obligation because of a past obligative event, probable outflow of resources is going to happen, which can be estimated, then only provision can be recognized. Clear? So that's a recognition criteria of provision. Chalo, tell me, when should the provision be recognized? If there's a present obligation because of a past obligating event, probable outflow of resources is going to happen, and which can be estimated reliably, then the provision is recognized. Clear? Next part is also done. How should we know whether there is a provision, present obligation or not? Present obligation will be obvious normally. But in rare cases like lawsuit, provisions, present obligation is there or not will not be obvious. In that case, you need to check. If it is, the obligation is probable, more likely than not, more than 50% chances, then we can say it's a present obligation and will provide. But that obligation is less likely, not probable, less than 50% chance, then it's just a possible obligation. You won't be taking up a provision, but you will be creating a contingent liability. So this part is done in the slide over here, where I've discussed when you, how you will check whether that there is a present obligation or not. You can just pause the video and note down the slide, or you can take a photo as the case may be, but accordingly it is done. Should I go ahead? Rest notes are already available in our website. When you see this revision lectures, you can just go to our website in the free notes section. Next. So past obligating event is must. Yes, past obligating event is must. If you have a past obligating event, then only we can say that present obligation because of that past event, then we can go up to provision or liability, as the case may be. So it's very important that there should be a past obligating event, or else you won't be able to reach up to that provision or liability. Now, what do you mean by that obligating event? That past obligating event can be a constructive obligation, can be a legal obligation, whatever be it the case. Obligating event means you don't have any other realistic alternative but to pay it. So we can say it's an obligating event. It can be a legal obligating event, it can be a constructive obligating event. Obligating event means you don't have any other realistic alternative but to pay it. So that is known as past obligating event. Clear? Next. Examples of past obligating events are given when you are promising warranty with the sale. The past obligating event is the sale where you promise the warranty, because of which you have to create a warranty provision. Let us say you have contaminated the land and now you need to restore it. So what's the obligating event? The contamination of land which you did was an obligating event. Just an example. Okay. Now, everyone needs to understand that what if there's a past obligating event and because of it there's a present obligation, then only we need to provide a provision. Let us say I'm standing today in the March and I'm going to incur expenses in April, May, June to operate in future. Should I provide that expense today in the March? I don't have an obligation, so I won't provide that obligation. You need to remember future operating expenses. You don't have any past obligation, so you do not provide. Simple as that. I am going to operate in April, May, June, and the electricity expense is going to happen in April, May, June. Should I provide as of now in the March? No. When that electricity expense will happen in April, May, June, you will book that electricity expense on accrual basis. How that electricity expenses are booked on accrual system? Simple. Expenses are booked when they are incurred. Goods or services, when they are incurred, expenses are incurred, you book that expenses on accrual system. So if the electricity is consumed in the month of April, May, June, it will be booked in April, May, June. You cannot provide in March even if you are going concern. Very simple concept that only because of past event, if there is a present obligation, you create a provision. If the expense is going to be incurred to operate in future, you cannot provide that expense now. Even if you think that you are going to be going concern, no problem. If the expense is going to be incurred to operate in future, you don't have an obligation as of now for that. When you operate in future, the expense will be incurred. You book that expense over there in accrual system. You cannot book the expense now. Clear? So conclusion is, you do not provide future operating expense because you don't have an obligating event. You can avoid them in future. Simple as that. Even if you are going concern, you can avoid them. Okay? Next. However, there are certain expenses which are independent of future course of action of an entity. So what are the expenses which are independent of the future course of action of an entity? Example is like this. Let us say government gave me the permission for installation of machine and working over there and operating my business over there. But government told me, the day you install the machine, remember, you have a liability that once you remove the machine, you will have to restore and give me the environment over there. So I got a license from the government to install a machine, but in the license only it is written that the day I install the machine, I have an obligation to restore the environment when I remove that machine, etc. Now, over here, what has happened is the obligating event exists independently of my future course of action, and that is the reason why decommissioning or restoration cost, which you have studied in Ind AS 16 already in our revision, it is done that decommissioning or restoration cost is provided as a provision also. Entries pass that asset account debit to provision because that liability exists independently of your future course of action, because it is the obligating event is the day on which you install the machine only the obligating event arises. Because in the contract, it is clearly written, the day you install the machine, you have to restore it when you remove it. Are you getting it? And that's the reason why the penalty for penalty or cleanup cost for the damages or that decommissioning cost for which there is already a past obligating event, so you need to provide them. Clear? I am obviously talking about those decommissioning restoration costs which exist independently of future course of action, means because they have arisen on installation of the machinery only, that you have to provide. Clear? Now, sometimes what happens that decommissioning or restoration cost arises as you produce more and more inventory. So as you go on producing more and more inventory, as you go on producing more and the decommissioning restoration cost goes on increasing because there's a contract that as you go on increasing, producing more and more damage is going. So kindly restore, and that contract is signed from start only. In that case, production of inventory is that obligating event. So sometimes you need to check whether the installation of the machinery is the obligating event or production of inventory is the obligating event. If installation of the machine is the obligating event, in that case, that is booked as per Ind AS 16 provision is created at the time of installation of machine. And accordingly, asset account debit to provision is passed. But if the obligating event is production of inventory over the period of time, then the provision is booked when that obligating event in production of inventory happens. So when that production of inventory happens, the inventory cost account debit to the provision, Ind AS 2 and interest pass. Inventory cost account debit as per Ind AS 2 to provisions, Ind AS 37. Clear? Next. So what to do about future cost, of the future expenses which are going to be incurred in future to operate in future? There are certain costs which are going to be incurred in future to operate in future. Should I provide from now? Let us say I am in the month of March. April, May, June, electricity cost is going to be incurred because I am going to consume electricity in April, May, June. Future cost which is going to be incurred because I am going to operate in future. Should I provide it from now? No, I will not provide because there is no present obligation. Simple as that. Clear? So only if there's a past obligating event, then only you provide it, and that's very important. If there's no past obligating event, there is a future expenses which is going to be incurred to operate in future, you don't provide now. When that expense happens, you book that. Now in that case, we have a very good example over there. Let us say As of the end of the March, there is a new law introduced, GST, and because of the new law introduced, I have to train my staff. But staff training has not happened. So there is a year end March which has happened. Before the year end March, there is a new law which is introduced, and I have to train my staff for that new law. But the staff training has not happened. Staff training has not happened. Now in the month of April, I conduct that staff training. So should I book the cost of that staff training in the month of March or in the month of April? It's very simple. As on the month of March. Did the staff training happen? No. Do you have an obligation for staff training? No. You want to do, I agree with that. But do you have a present obligation because of a past event? No. So no provision is created as on March. When on in April that actual training happens, so on accrual basis of system, accrual system of accounting, the actual cost will be booked at that time. Are you getting it? So very important that there should be a past obligating event to book a provision. If you are going to train the staff in future and now only you want to provide, that's nonsense. Obligating event is only not there. Obligating event will be there when the staff training happens. So book the cost accordingly. Simple as that. Clear? So what's the obligating event in case of staff training? The actual training happening, and accordingly use the accrual system of accounting. Next, second example was like this, that one second, I'll show it to on the slide. Your staff training example was this one, that a law was introduced before March and you thought that you will be doing staff training because you want to make your staff aware of that law. So you did the staff training in April, so you cannot book as on March. There was no obligating event as on March. You could have avoided in future. There's no past event which makes an obligating event. But now second example, let us say year end is March again. Now, there's a new law before March that requires you to fit the smoke filter by September of next year. So there's a March ending. Before March ending, there's a new law. New law requires you to fit the smoke filters before next year September. Okay. Now, it is nowhere related to any past event. It does not say that you have installed the machine. It simply says that year ending is March. Before the March, the law is introduced and says that kindly fix the smoke filters by September next year. There is no past obligating event. So as on 31st March, you have not fitted the smoke filter. What to do? Since as on 31st March, you have not fitted the folder, you won't be providing for the cost of smoke filter because the obligating event for the smoke filter is fitting of that smoke filter when that obligating event happens. There is no past other obligating event. You can just avoid it. So, but then law requires you to fit by September. So as of now, there is no breach of law also. So no provisions for penalty, etc. is also required as on March. Law requires that kindly fix the full filter by September next year. So when there is a March today, I am not fitted to smoke filters. There is no obligating event which requires me to pay for that smoke filter. Whom I will pay? No. So there is no requirement. However, if let us say that September crosses and next year end comes, next year 31st March comes, and by the September you are required to fit the smoke filter but you did not fit the smoke filter, there's a violation of law comes and next year end comes, then what to do? Since there's a violation of law, we'll have to provide for penalty. But still you won't be providing for smoke filters. There's no obligating event. Smoke filter amount is payable when that smoke filter is fitted. So there's no provision for that smoke filter which is required to be paid. However, but the provision for penalty is required to be paid based on the assessment of the law, because there's a breach of law which has happened, and accordingly we had considered this module example over there. Clear? Next, then I discuss this. Let us say I buy a truck. Okay, I buy a truck at 0 year. I buy a truck over here at 0 year. Okay. Now 3 years have lapsed. As per law over here, compulsory overhaul is required at the end of 5 year. Or else sell the truck. Okay. So I have bought a truck in 0 year, 3 years have already lapsed, I have reached up to 3 years, I am standing over here. I know that at the end of 5 years, I have to compulsory do the overhauling of that truck as per the law. Okay. So should I book that overhauling cost which is required to be done at the end of 5 years now at the end of 3 years? No, there's no obligating event for overhaul. I can easily avoid. Obligating event means you cannot avoid. This too I can easily avoid. I can sell the truck also even before 5 years. So I will not provide that overhauling cost at the end of 3 years. That overhauling cost will be provided when it is payable. When that obligating event happens, when the overhaul happens. So then how accounting will be done? For that, you can go for that component accounting which you might have studied in the Ind AS 16. If that overall cost is a material cost, subsequent cost, which has a future economic benefit and it can be recognized. So that what will happen is this new overall cost, when it is incurred, will be recognized as an asset and then depreciated over the balance life. And if there's an old component still pending, that will be derecognized. Component accounting. When the component is replaced, new component is accounted and old component is derecognize, that component accounting of Ind AS 16 will be applicable. At the end of 3 years, you won't be provided for a cost which is going to be incurred when you overhaul at 5 years, because you can just avoid. There's no obligating, past obligating event which has happened for the same. Clear? There should be an event, but that event has not happened. There's no event over there. So accordingly, we considered all the examples over there. Okay. Now, many a times it happens that when you create a provision, it is payable to some person. We know that it is payable to some person. That identity of that individual person is not known. That's fine, but it should be payable to some person. Example, provision for warranty. Now, you know provision for warranty is payable to some other person when you create the provision for warranty. But you don't know exactly which person it is payable. That's fine. Let us say I have sold 10,000 products and I create a provision for warranty that out of that few people can come. So the provision of warranty is payable for some person. I don't know exactly identity of the person who will come. That's fine, totally fine. Okay. Yeah. Check next. Next case is like this, that let us say there's an obligating event and that's a constructive obligation. So before the end of the reporting period, management had taken a decision because of it there's an obligating event, but that decision was never communicated, no valid expectation was created. And after the year end, but before approval, that it was communicated and a valid expectation was created. Then what to do as on year end? As on year end, board has taken a decision because of it there's an obligation, but it is not communicated, no expectation is created in the mind of another person. After the balance sheet date, but before approval, it is communicated and the expectations are also created. So basically, as on the year end, is there an obligating event? No. What they say is you have to check whatever condition is existing on the balance sheet date. Even if there are evidences which are availing after the balance sheet date but before reporting period, you have to check, do they provide an extra evidence of the condition existing on the balance sheet date? If they provide an extra evidence of the condition which is existing on the balance sheet, then only it will be adjusted, or else it is a non-adjusting event. So simple, you have to check whether the obligation is there or not on the balance sheet date. If the obligation is there on the balance sheet date, then only you will provide. If the obligation arises after the balance sheet date but before, already it will account it in the next year, no? Not now. Clear? Now, many a times obligation arises because of some law. So that obligation should be booked only when the law is virtually certain. So that, let us say there's a new law which is coming in, and because of it I am going to get some obligation. I already spoiled the environment, there's no law in the past. So now there's a new law and that new law requires kindly restore, but that new law is still in draft form, it is not enacted. But if the new law comes, I will have to restore entire past problem, damages which I have done. So how should I provide or not? They say if there's a liability which can arise from a proposed law, that should be recognized as a provision only when that law is virtually certain. Now, what do you mean by virtually certain? Depends upon the environment which you operate. In India, generally virtually certain means passed by both the House of Parliaments, only precedent sign is pending. So we can say it's virtually certain in India. It depends upon case to case basis in each country. Clear? Accordingly, examples are given for the same. Okay. So now I'm done with that present obligation part. Now there are a few points which we'll discuss in the next video, probable outflow of economic resources, etc. And we take a pause over here for today. So let us continue with the revision of Ind AS 37. Till the last time we had studied that for a provision we need a present obligation because of a past obligating event, probable outflow of economic resources, and it can be estimated, so we create a provision. Out of that, present obligation due to the past obligating event was completely done, where we had decided that it is very important that there should be some past obligating event, because of it there should be a present obligation. If there is no obligating event, then there is no present obligation, then there is no provision. Example, I have bought a truck and law says that every 5 years I need to overhaul. 3 years have lapsed. So there is no obligating event for overhauling. So I will not book and I will go for Ind AS 16 component accounting. So that was the last concept. And on that note, I continue. Now, next thing is for it to be a provision, the probable outflow of economic resources should also be there. Means outflow of economic resources should also be probable. See, that's the next point over there. That is also one of the conditions. Chicken up. What do you mean by probable? So probable is defined in Ind AS 37 as more likely than that, means more than 50%. Means if it is more likely that outflow of resources is going to happen, then we can say probable outflow of economic resource. That is one of the condition. Now what happens is, why this point is specifically given, I can say one example over there. Let us say in case of warranty, what happens is I have sold 10,000 units during the year, and I at the end of the year I create a warranty provision, because there's a present obligation because of a past obligating event known as sales, which will result in outflow of economic resources. Okay, and I can estimate, and I have the experience to estimate, etc. So let us say I can easily estimate that present obligation for warranty. So let us say when I provide for warranty, I holistically think out of this 10,000, on an average 10 products will require the you can say a replacement, and that 10 products will have a cost of this much, and accordingly I create a warranty provision. Now what happens is I check the holistic warranty probability for all the products, and then accordingly decide. If I try to find out probability for each and every product individually for warranty, maybe it might be very less. Example, for this one product, what is the probability of coming? For the second product, what is the, if I try to check it on individual, what is the probable outflow of economic resources which is going to happen for individual product? It will be negligible maybe. And therefore, what happens is when there are similar number of obligations, then what you need to do, number of similar obligation, then what you need to do, this probable outflow of economic outflow of resources, probable outflow of economic resources, you need to check by grouping them, class of obligation as a whole. You need to check class of obligation as a whole, and if as a class of obligation as a whole, warranty as a whole, if I think that outflow is probable, then I will provide for the same, even if the individual outflow might not be that relevant for us. Clear with that? Accordingly, example of warranty is given by the module over there. Next is one more condition is there for a provision that estimated means we are able to estimate the provision reliably. In rare cases it is possible that we cannot estimate the provisions reliably, and if we cannot estimate the provisions reliably, then we won't be creating a provision because the condition won't be fulfilled. And you know, when the conditions of this provisions which are to be considered together, they don't get fulfilled, there's a possibility of contingent liability. Example, if you have a possible obligation, contingent liability. Present obligation but outflow not probable, contingent liability. Present obligation but reasonable estimate not possible, contingent liability. Accordingly, examples are given, and that estimate is not possible, reliable estimate is not possible, that is only in rare cases it can happen. Okay, next. So we are done with provisions entirely. Now let us go to contingent liability. And you know the definition of contingent liability, that is also taught to you. Now these are the three cases, and there's an or in between, so any one of them, it's a contingent liability. Now what to do of that contingent liability? Contingent liability are first of all not recognized. Then contingent liability are disclosed. So contingent liability, everyone remember, they are not recognized, they are disclosed. Disclosed where? In the notes accounts. When it is not remote. So contingent liabilities are disclosed if it is not remote. What will happen if the contingent liabilities are remote? If the contingent liabilities are remote, they will neither be recognized nor be disclosed. We will be doing nothing. Clear? So next point is like this. Let us say A, B and C jointly and severally own 300 to D. So D can ask from entire 300 from A, or 100 from A, 100 from B, because they are jointly and severally liable. If A pays entire 300, then he can recover from B and C. But what happens, let us, if A, B and C are jointly and liable, jointly and severally liable to pay 300 to C, na? So A will record his own liability first to 100. But whatever B and C are liable to pay, A, that's a contingent liability for A. Because if B and C do not pay, or B and C become insolvent, then that is required to be paid by A only. So whenever there is a joint and several liability, the obligation to be met by other person is a contingent liability. Simple as that. Okay? Okay, next. Now, this contingent liabilities are assessed continuously to check whether they are probable or not. And the day when that contingent liability becomes probable, they are recognized as a provision. So normally contingent liability are not recognized, they are disclosed unless they are remote. So if they are remote, they are not disclosed, but they are continuously assessed, and if they become probable, then a liability is shown. Accordingly, a conclusion is given over there. If there is a present obligation where there is probable outflow of economic resources and which can be estimated also, then a provision is recognized and disclosure of provision is given. But whether there is a possible obligation or there is a present obligation but outflow is not probable, etc., then no provision, only disclosure of contingent liability. What if that contingent liability is remote? Then no provision, no disclosure. Okay, very simple as that. And accordingly, conclusion is given over there. Next, what to do of the contingent asset? Contingent asset are not recognized. Contingent asset are not recognized. Okay, and when that contingent asset becomes virtually certain, then only they are recognized. So contingent asset are not recognized. However, when that contingent asset becomes virtually certain, then only they are recognized. Okay, the reason for the same is if you recognize a contingent asset, it's like an income you are recognizing which may never be realized. So conservatism, contingent asset not recognized unless they become virtually certain. Now what happens if a contingent asset is not virtually certain but just only probable? If the contingent asset is only probable but not virtually certain, then only disclosures will happen. Obviously, since it's a contingent asset, means inflow of economic resources may happen, but it depends upon happening, non-happening or future uncertain event not within the control of the enterprise. The contingent assets are continuously assessed to check whether they have become virtually certain or not. Okay, so conclusion is given below that if contingent asset have become virtually certain, then recognize as an asset only. If they are probable, then do not recognize an asset but disclose. And if they are not probable, do nothing, neither asset nor disclosure. And accordingly, conclusion is given about liabilities and asset. Liability virtually certain, provision. Liability probable, then also provision. Liability is a possible one, then only disclosure. Remote, then no disclosure. But contingent asset virtually certain, recognize. Probable, only disclosure. And when it is possible or remote, nothing doing. Clear with the conclusion. Accordingly, limits are given over there. That percentages given over there are just for reference by the institute. Exam, you need to consider virtually certain, probable, possible, remote. Probable means more likely. Possible means less likely. Less than probable. Okay, accordingly examples are given. Next, now we have considered entirely what to do of that provisions, contingent liability, contingent asset, recognize what to do. Now comes the measurement. Okay, now first of all, provision is recognized, so okay, we have to measure it also for passing the journal entry. What's the journal entry for provision? P&L or expense account debit, that expense can be capitalized also in some cases, expense account debit to provision. Okay, now that what should be the amount? So amount should be the best estimate that is required to settle that obligation. So there's a provision, so there's an obligation. So what's the best estimate to settle that obligation is considered as the measurement amount. Okay, now that is the amount that a firm will rationally pay to settle that liability. Okay, obviously judgment of the management, experience in the similar transaction, evidences, etc. should be considered. In fact, sometimes the reports of independent experts should also be considered to check what should be the measurement. Okay, next, many times what happens is after balance sheet date but before approval you get an extra evidence. So should we consider that extra evidence or not? The extra evidence after the balance sheet date but before approval should be considered only if it provides extra evidence of the condition existing on the balance sheet date. Means you have to apply normal Ind AS 10 on the same if there's a evidence which is after balance sheet date but before reporting period. Okay, next, many times what happens during measurement, there can be a lot of uncertainties. So we think that because the provision by its nature are uncertain only. Okay, so let us say we are trying to create a provision for warranty and there's a lot of uncertainty. So how you should resolve that uncertainty? They say try to use probabilities, try to expect the different values of warranty claim which can be there and try to attach probabilities to them. So when you have different values and probabilities attached to them, when you multiply, you get something known as expected value. Value into probability is expected value, and you can use that expected value over there for measurement of the provision. Value into probability, what are the different values possible with what are the different probabilities. Accordingly, there are certain examples and illustrations given by the institute over there. Nothing much is required to be known. You just need to know that when there are uncertainties, you try to resolve that uncertainties by using something as probability distribution. Okay, accordingly, few example is given, not that important, then we go ahead. Always remember that when you measure the provisions, that provisions will be before tax concept. And what will be the tax impact of the same? The tax, income tax impact of the same will be covered in Ind AS 12, not now over here. Okay, next, sir, there are a lot of risks, there are a lot of variabilities. So how that risk and variabilities are dealt with? Now, when we estimate provision by its nature, there will be certain variability or risk. Risk means the fluctuations or the variability. So by its nature only, there will be a lot of risk or variability which is possible. So how we should adjust? Now, normally what happens is when we apply that conservatism, let us say there's a warranty provision which I'm creating and that can fluctuate. So when I'm trying to apply conservatism, so there's a chances that when I try to adjust the risk of that fluctuation, more or less amount, when we adjust that risk, basically the by conservatism we will show a slightly higher amount of liability. So normally what happens when you adjust that risk, slightly the amount of liability or provision which is shown can increase. Okay, but you need to be very careful. You need not be over conservative. Overstatement of liability is also not good. So you have to balance over there. Prudence has to be used, rational thinking has to be used, and accordingly the risk has to be adjusted. Now, you should also take care that you avoid duplication of adjustments of risk. Let us say risk is there, so you adjust the cash flows also, DCF also, both also, then it will be a problem. Okay, many times what happens is when you calculate the provision, now you need to consider the present value of the provision. That is given in the next point that when you are calculating provision and the time value of money is relevant, then the provision is measured at present value. Provision is measured at present value. Now, when you are adjusting risk and there's present value concept, then how to do in that case? They say that provisions have to be recognized at present value if the time value of money is relevant, and now you need to adjust the risk. So, as we had studied in Ind AS 36 earlier, this risk can be adjusted either from the cash flows or this risk can be adjusted from the DCF, because when we want to calculate the present value, we make the table. What table we make is year cash flow DCF PV. We make the table year cash flow DCF PV. So, first option of adjustment of risk is we adjust the risk from the cash flows. Second option of adjustment of risk is we can adjust the risk from the DCF. Third possibility is after calculating PV, we can directly adjust the risk from the PV. So these are the various options. So understand that risk has to be adjusted, but duplication has to be avoided. If the risk is already adjusted in cash flow, then you won't be adjusting again in DCF. Okay. Accordingly, risk can be either adjusted from cash flows or DCF or the present values, and such concepts are already taught to you in Ind AS 36. Okay. Now, that is the next thing which is given, and then later on you need to give the disclosure about that uncertainties which you have adjusted. The next concept which I have just told, that when you are measuring that provision should be measured at the present value if the time value of money is material. And whether the time value of money is material or not, that management will decide, and from exam purpose it will be given in the question. Okay. Now, so what will happen if there is both the probabilities also and the present values also? Then what you will do? If there is probability is also in the present value, both of them are there, then how should we do? Then they say, first do one thing. First calculate the present value of the different options. So there is a first option, make year cash flow DCF PV, get the present value. Second option, make year cash flow DCF PV, get the present value. Once you get different present values, then on that different present values, apply the probability and get the expected present value. So this is the order which is given. Next, when you consider that discount rate also should also be pre-tax. Try to understand this entire provision, concept of provision is pre-tax. So all the cash flows, DCF, entire amount of that provision is pre-tax concept. So DCF should also be pre-tax. And in fact, the DCF which we use, it should be a pre-tax rate which reflects the current market assessment of the time value of money and the risk which we want to adjust for that liability. So DCF should consider two things: the current assessment of the time value of money and the risk which we want to adjust from that DCF, and the DCF should be the pre-tax rate. Okay. Next, if the cash flows are already adjusted for a particular risk, then that risk should not be adjusted in DCF. That is the next point which is done. Okay. Next comes the future event. What happens is, many a time when we are measuring provision, certain future events can affect the amount of provision, the measurement of provision. I can give you an example. Let us say I am creating a provision for decommissioning or restoration liability. Okay. Now, I expect certain future events. I expect that there's a technology for cleaning up of the environment, and this technology is constantly improving. So I expect that the technology for cleaning up of the environment will improve. And if I have such an expectation about that future event, that the technology for environment restoration is going to improve, and my cost is going to decrease, then at today, at the present time, when we are measuring provision, the amount of that provision will get affected. So over here, the Ind AS says that which future event should be considered and which future event should not be considered. They say that estimated future events can be considered while measuring the provision today, provided you have an objective sufficient evidence that they will occur. And the example given over there is, if there's a present technology and which is constantly improving, so we have evidence that it is going to improve in future and cost is going to reduce. In that case, while making the provision today, we can expect the improvement in the technology and reduction in cost, and accordingly create the provision today. However, they say that wait, be cautious. You cannot expect entirely new technology in future because there is no specific evidence of the same. Okay, so expected future events can be considered when we measure the provision today, provided you have a sufficient objective evidence that they will occur. Simple as that. An example is present technology which is improving, there can be a sufficient objective evidence available for. But you cannot have a sufficient objective evidence for altogether new technology which is not there at all. Clear? So accordingly it is given. Next, sir. Should we consider a new legislation while measuring the provision? Now, if there is a new legislation and which requires me to pay certain amount, etc., and I am creating a provision, so should that new legislation which is still in draft format be considered while measuring the provision? They say that new legislation which requires you to create a provision because of some existing obligation, etc., there is a past obligation because of which there is a amount which will be required to be based on a new legislation which is still in draft format. They say that provision, that amount should be measured based on that new legislation only if that new legislation is virtually certain to be enacted. So I am measuring a provision and that is affected by a new legislation. That new legislation should be used in the measurement of the provision, provided that new legislation is virtually certain to be enacted, then only it should be considered. Next, should the disposal of asset be considered while measuring the provision? Let us say I am trying to create a provision for restoration or decommissioning. Okay, so that to you all know that we pass a entry asset account debit to provision, asset account debit Ind AS 16 to provision, Ind AS 37. Okay, so I'm passing that entry. Now I know that when I'm going to decommissioning or restore, I'm going to sell certain asset and there's going to be gain from that asset. Should that expected gain from the disposal of asset should be adjusted from the provision now? No, that is a separate event. The expected gain from the disposal of asset will be recognized as per the respective Ind AS when that disposal happens, not now. So gain from the expected disposal of asset, even if it is related to the provision which is created, you cannot subtract the expected gain from the disposal asset while measuring the provision. Simple as that. Okay, next comes the reimbursement concept. Very simple concept. Reimbursement, what should we do? Reimbursement means we have to pay to someone and then that amount can be reimbursed to us by someone. Okay, whatever amount we want to pay to someone, that too we have to apply the normal logic and create a provision, etc., if there's a present obligation. Now what about that reimbursement, sir, that we are going to get? The reimbursement should be recognized separately as an asset only when that reimbursement is virtually certain, because reimbursement which you are going to receive are like a contingent asset. So reimbursement should be recognized as a separate asset only if it is virtually certain. Means two things has to be done. First, the provision has to be created separately, and then that reimbursement should be created as a separate asset. Okay. Now, so in the balance sheet, the provision will be shown separately on the liability side based on the logic we have studied for provision, that present obligation because of past event, etc., etc., and it will be measured based on the things which you have studied for provision. Next, this reimbursement will be recognized separately as an asset on the asset side only when that reimbursement is virtually certain. Now, in the P&L, you may net off, that is allowed. So in P&L, the related expense for that provision, related thing for with that provision is created and there's a reimbursement. In P&L, that can be shown as net off thing, but in the balance sheet, a separate provision liability and a separate asset should be shown, and reimbursement can be shown as asset only when it is virtually certain. Clear? Now, many times it happens that let us say we are a party of some transaction and some party, third party, is liable to pay directly to the customer and we are nowhere liable at all on our own. In that case, we need not create any provision because we are not liable. So where this concept comes? This concept comes that when we are liable to our customers and we are claiming reimbursement, so in that case, when we are personally liable to that customer, we have to provide a provision, and reimbursement can be shown as a separate asset separately. Clear with that? Accordingly, they have given the conclusion of this, that when we don't have any obligation, then there's no provision, no disclosure, no reimbursement. But when we have an obligation and there's going to be a reimbursement and reimbursement is virtually certain, we create a provision. We show the reimbursement as separate asset. Okay. And one more thing, reimbursement cannot exceed the amount of provision in such cases. And further, in P&L they can be net off. In balance sheet, they're not allowed to be net off. Specific disclosures are required to be given. Okay, so what if that reimbursement is not virtually certain? Then provision though we'll have to recognize based on the normal rules. Reimbursement cannot be recognized, but it is probable, then it can be disclosed. Okay, next is change in provision. Now when we had created a provision, now we had passed the entry expense account debit that can be capitalized or go to P&L wherever to provision. Now in future that provision can increase or decrease, it can change, no problem. Accordingly, it should be accounted. When the provision is no longer required, it can be even reversed. So what entry will be passed for reversal of provision? Exactly opposite of the same. Provision account debit to expense. Clear? Now, many times provision, you need to know that provision, if you have created for XYZ amount, that provision can be used only for that XYZ amount. You cannot use that provision for ABC expenses. So provision should be used only for the expense of purpose for which it is made. It cannot be used for other purpose. And therefore, if there's a change in provision or reversal of provision, you need to reverse that. And if there's another provision required, you need to make that other provision. Further, next, the provision can also change because of discounting. Let us say today we created a provision for dismantling, decommissioning restoration cost. Okay, so 0 year we passed the entry, expense account debit that can be capitalized. So asset account debit to provision. But that has to be created at present value. So every year we need to account that interest. So accounting of that interest, what entry is passed? For accounting of that interest every year, time value of money every year, the entry passes borrowing cost account debit. borrowing cost account debit to provision for time value of money. Okay, and the reversal entry which we studied was provision account debit to expense depending upon that other standard. So reversal entry is provision account debit to expense, and the time value of money entry is borrowing cost account debit to provision. Are you getting it? Check. Next. Use of provision, we have already done that. It should be used only against the expenses for which it is created, or else you will have to reverse it if it is no longer there. So should we create a provision for future operating losses or future operating expenses? That is already discussed, that for future operating losses or future operating expense, you don't have a present obligating event or a past obligating you don't have a present obligation due to a past obligating event. You cannot provide for future operating expenses or future operating losses for now. Clear? Or instead of that, just if there are, if you expect a future operating losses or future operating expenses, then what you can do is you can test the current asset which is there for impairment, the asset which is there for impairment, to check whether there is an impairment or not. Okay, accordingly you can check over there. Sorry. Next one, onerous contract. Now, onerous contract is an exceptional case. Onerous contract means a contract in which unavoidable cost of meeting the obligation exceeds the economic benefit to be derived from that contract. Okay. Example, I have entered into contract to purchase certain things from you at 45 rupees a kg, 45 rupees a unit, 10,000 units. Okay, and I have promised to purchase, you have promised to sell, and I have told you if I breach the contract, I will pay 60,000 as damages to you. Now, in future period, my business changes, that material is no longer required. So, I have one option is I purchase that material 10,000 units from you at 45 per unit and then just dispose of in the market. I don't use because my business plan has changed, and let us say the market price is 40 per unit. So there's a loss of 5 per unit, 50,000 is a total loss which can be estimated if I fulfill the contract, and if I breach the contract, there's a loss of 60,000 which is going to happen. Now in any case, there's a loss which is going to happen in future because today I discontinued a particular business. So therefore a contract which you have entered now has become an onerous contract. Because the unavoidable cost of meeting the obligation exceeds the benefit to be derived from that contract. Onerous contract has to be compulsory accounted and provided, and when that loss is provided under onerous contract, when that event happens which makes the contract onerous. So what was the event that which made the contract onerous? The day on which we changed our business plan, discontinued our business, that was the day on which that contract became onerous. So we need to provide. That's a very exceptional case. Normally we do not provide for an executory contract. But if that contract become onerous, the day on which that contract become onerous, we need to provide for that loss, and that loss will be lower of that cost, net cost of fulfilling the contract, or penalty from failure to fulfill the contract, whatever is the lower of that, you will provide that. Further, before you are providing for onerous contract loss, you need to check the asset for impairment also. Clear? Next, restructuring was the next thing. What's the meaning of restructuring? Restructuring is a change. A material change in the business which is done by the management, where the scope or the manner in which the business is conducted gets altered. If the scope or manner in which the business is conducted is altered materially, then that is known as restructuring. Example, I was earlier doing only normal trading where I have a shop, and now I am completely into online. The scope or the manner in which the business has been conducted completely changes. That's an example of restructuring. Second example of restructuring is there are a lot of layers of management. An entity does internal restructuring and entire hierarchy is changed, and certain levels of management are also eliminated, and there's a new structure, new reporting. That's a restructuring. So examples of restructuring are sale or termination of line of business, closure of business or relocation of business from one country region to another, eliminating a layer of management, change in management structures. Okay, fundamental reorganizing in business where the material effect on the nature and focus of the operation. So these are just an examples of restructuring. Now entity need to create a provision for restructuring if there's a present obligation because of a past event. Even a provision for restructuring cost is required. So what do you mean by restructuring cost? What costs are included? What costs are not included? When that obligating event for that restructuring provision arises, we'll consider all that thing. Restructuring means, do you understand? Ultimately, either the scope or the manner in which the business conducted gets changed, and there's a main involvement of the management in the same, major change happens. So that is known as restructuring. Restructuring costs are provided if there is due to some past obligating event. What are included in that cost, what are not included, we'll consider that part. Now, example of restructuring I'll give you so that we understand what's that past obligating event because of that provision for that restructuring cost is required. Example, let us say management decided that it will terminate a particular line of business, and because of that termination of particular line of business, we will have to compensate certain purchasers or suppliers or our customers based on the past relationships and to our employees also who are remote to maintain good relationships. So what we did was we formulated the plan of restructuring and we communicated the plan of restructuring to those affected. So this is what we are planning to do and this is what can happen to you. So this is how we are ready to compensate to, and that plan was communicated to those affected. Now what NTT did? NTT by its action, by its statements, accepted certain responsibilities and created a valid expectation in the mind of other person that NTT is going to discharge that responsibility. So NTT basically created a constructive obligation, but this time the constructive obligation was regarding a restructuring that NTT was going to do. In that case, if the NTT has created a constructive obligation regarding the restructuring in the minds of that other persons that they will be compensated in a particular manner and they have a valid expectation that the NTT will discharge its obligation, in that case we have to provide for that restructuring cost. And accordingly, example of constructive obligation in case of restructuring is given over there. That constructing obligation arises when there is a detailed plan identifying the business affected, location affected, people affected, compensation, expenses, etc., and when the plan will be implemented, and there's a valid expectation that NTT will fulfill all the plan will be implemented and NTT will fulfill all its promises, then there's a constructive obligation. Okay, now further, if there's a restructuring thing which is announced, it should be given in the plan that restructuring is attempted to be completed in a particular time frame, a short time frame. If restructuring is going to be done after a very long period of time, then it's not a constructive obligation. I tell my staff that after 20 years I'm going to retire, 20 years I'm going to continue, but after 20 years I'm going to retire and go to Mauritius and etc. and enjoy over there. So that's not a restructuring thing, because there's a sufficient long period of time and my plan can change between, and that won't create a valid expectation in the mind of my other employees also, etc. Okay, so it should be tried to be implemented in the short period of time. What is that long period? Short period is not defined. You have to consider the case to case basis. Now many times it happens that board has decided that they will do restructuring before the end of the financial year, but they have not communicated that. They have just kept the decision, board decision, in the drawer. It is not communicated to those affected. It has not created a valid expectation. Then there is no constructive obligation, and you need to check whether the constructive obligation exists at the end of the reporting period. If there are certain events after the reporting period but before balance sheet date, but it does not signify the position existing on the balance sheet date, we won't adjust. You need to check whether that obligation exists at the end of reporting period. That is very important. Even if some evidences after that are considered, but you need to check whether that even whether that evidences give extra evidence of the condition existing on the balance sheet date. Okay, now many times what happens is those affected, the employees or the other stakeholders who are going to be affected, they are only having a representation on the board of directors. Their representatives are there in the board of directors, and then the board of directors have decided. Then though we can say that it has been communicated and a valid expectation is created in the mind of those affected, because they are having the representative in the board, and then the board has taken a decision. Okay, other way around, many times it can also happen that once first we tell to our employees this is what we are planning to do, but we have not taken a decision, and it depends upon the later board decision. Don't have any expectations in your mind as of now, but this is what we can do in future. Don't have valid expectation in your mind, this is what we can do in future, but it depends upon if the board approves. Employees say okay, and then later on board approves. Later on when the board approves, then that may result in obligating event, because there are some events earlier that, so not just the board event always results into an obligating event, but there are something more than that. Maybe a past communication, maybe a future communication, and together they can be considered as an obligating event, constructive obligation. You need to check on case to case basis. Now what are considered, what costs are considered in this restructuring provision? So restructuring provision, we can consider only the direct cost attributable to restructuring. You cannot consider the cost regarding ongoing activities. So in restructuring cost, only direct expenses regarding restructuring like compensation, etc., can be considered. Ongoing activities cost like rent, electricity cannot be considered as a part of restructuring provision. Further, staff retraining, staff relocation, marketing cost, investment in new system, they cannot be part of restructuring provision specifically given in Ind AS. We'll have to follow Ind AS. So staff retraining, staff relocation, marketing cost, investment in new systems, they are not a part of restructuring provision. So how they will be accounted? If they are not a part of restructuring provision, they will be accounted normal accrual system of accounting. When the expenses are incurred, you need to book that. Okay, Next, future operating losses, gain on expected disposal, they are not considered while considering the restructuring provision. They are based on the normal logic already studied, and accordingly we are done with restructuring provision. Okay. Next is certain disclosures. They are once read that for each class of provision, you need to give a reconciliation from opening and the closing balances of provision, like opening plus provision made during the year, reversals, usage, time value of money, closing balances. Then you need to give description about that provision, uncertainty, what is there, etc., assumptions made, reimbursements. Then you need to disclose by class of contingent liabilities, description about that contingent liability, financial effect, uncertainties, etc. Then you need to disclose about contingent assets, so on so forth. Disclosures are required over there. That's once read, not that thing, but okay. Then there's one more point which is there in restructuring, which is still left and later is written over there, that many a times when we do restructuring, there's sale of certain operation or assets which is also allowed. Now that sale cannot be considered as committed until the purchaser is found and a binding sale agreement is done. So sale will be accounted separately, and the other part of restructuring will be accounted separately. Example, I am planning to dispose of an operation, and for that I have told my employee that this is what I am doing to do, and I have created a constructive obligation, and I have told that employee that I am going to give them compensation, and that has created a valid expectation. Everything is let us assume constructive obligation. In that case, whatever compensation for employee, that can be created as a restructuring provision. But the sale cannot be considered till that time you have found a purchaser and a binding sale agreement is that, then sale will be considered separately. You cannot mix it over here. Clear? Accordingly, it is given. Then we have Appendix C levies. Appendix C levies talks about certain levy by government. Okay. So very, you need to be very sure. This Appendix C to Ind AS 37 talks only about accounting for the liability to pay levy. What is that levy, sir? Example is GST. So liability to pay GST, the liability aspect of that is covered in Ind AS 37 Appendix C. What will happen to the debit aspect, I don't know. This is what in Appendix C says. You have to account as per other standard. So when you are trying to account for the liability to pay GST, that is covered in Appendix C to Ind AS 37, it will be accounted as per Appendix C to Ind AS 37, and normal rules studied above shall not apply. But this shall apply to only those liability to pay levy which are of certain amount and timing. So for a liability to pay levy to be covered under Appendix C, the amount and timing should be certain. And you know, normally if I'm providing you teaching services, I know the value of teaching services, I know the rate of teaching services, I know the time of supply of reaching services, I know what is GST payable and when the GST. If the timing and amount is certain, that GST payable on that teaching services is a levy which will be, and accounting for that liability to pay levy will be covered over here. And you know, for your knowledge purpose, GST, there is something known as you can say forward charge. What happens in that case is, let us say I am providing teaching services to you, I am the supplier, you are the receiver. So I will collect GST from you, and I am liable to pay to government. So as a person, I am liable to pay GST to the government, so that is liability to pay levy. And the amount and timing is certain, so that will be covered over here, and how it will be accounted, we will consider. Just giving an example of GST, and why GST is covered, that is also we will consider. Sometimes GST can be payable under reverse charge, so that is also a liability to pay levy whose timing and amount is certain, so that can be also covered over here. Okay. Next, the accounting for the cost aspect is not covered over here, means the debit aspect is not covered in this Appendix C. The credit aspect, the liability aspect is covered in Appendix C to Ind AS 37. Are you getting it? Next, what do you mean by levy? Levy means a charge imposed by the government based on rules and regulations. Okay, which results in outflow of economics resources. So GST is a charge levied by government based on rules and regulations and laws, and it will result in outflow of economic resources. So GST is an example of levy. But this levy excludes other outflow which are already covered in other Ind AS. So if there's a particular outflow which is already covered in other Ind AS, so that is not covered over here. Example, income taxes are specifically covered in Ind AS 12, so not covered over here. So we will remember levy is a charge levied by the government in accordance with the laws, regulations, but it does not include those outflow of resources which is already covered by other standard. Further, it does not include fine and penalty. So fine and penalty payable under GST law is also not covered. Basic GST payable under GST law is covered, but fine and penalty payable under GST law is not covered where? In Appendix C. So if fine and penalty payable under GST law is not covered under Appendix C to Ind AS 37, where it will be covered? It will be covered under normal provisions of Ind AS 37. Go now, whether there is a present obligation or no, etc., etc. Clear? Next, many a times what happens is we acquire assets or services from government, and we are liable to pay to the government for that assets and services. That is not covered over here. That goes to the normal Ind AS 37. Clear? Next, many times what happens is liability arises because of emission trading schemes like carbon credits. If we have polluted more, then we will have to buy that carbon credit from other person who is polluting less. So liability can arise because of that emission trading schemes. That is also not covered over here. So normal levy, which is a liability, normal levy, the liability aspect of that levy, which is certain in amount and timing, that is covered over here in Appendix C. Those are liabilities which are already covered in other Ind AS, they are not covered. Fine and penalty are not covered. Payment made to the government for assets or services, that is not covered. Liabilities from emission trading schemes, they are not covered over here. Government is defined. Normal government means government, government agencies or bodies which are at local level, national level or international level. All form of governments are covered over here. Now, sir, how to account for that GST? Or basically, how to account for that levy which is covered over here? The liability aspect of the levy which is certain in amount and timing, which is covered in this Appendix C, how to account it as per Appendix C? Appendix C said that that liability to pay levy, that liability should be accounted when the activity that triggers the payment happens. When the activity that triggers the payment happens, the obligating event happens, you will account that liability. In GST, the activity which triggers the payment, the obligating event is the supply. And basically, when the time of supply happens, you will account for that GST liability. So if I am providing you teaching services and the time of supply of this teaching services is in May, then I'll account that GST liability which I am required to pay on this teaching services to government in May. Clear? So liability to pay levy to the government is accounted when the activity which triggers the payment happens. An activity which triggers the payment in GST is the supply, the time of supply, that is the obligating event. Clear? Now let us say I am in the month of March, okay, and I know that I am going to operate in April because I have certain firm contracts and I am going to supply certain services in April. So should I book that GST liability from the March itself for the supply which I am going to make in April, the time of supply which is there in April? So they say no. When that activity which triggers the payment happens, then only you will account for that levy. You cannot say I am going to operate in future, and since I am going to operate in future, then there is a supply which I am going to do and the time of supply will going to come and I will be paying. So you cannot account now. You will account when that thing happens in future. Simple as that. Yeah. So what if that liability to pay levy is recognized progressively as per the law, like continuous supply of goods or services? In liability to pay levy is recognized progressively as per law, then over here also they are progressively recognized over the as per the law. So if as per the law, in case of continuous supply of goods or services in GST, you have the time of supply given for that different event, accordingly you will be considering over here in accounts and accordingly you provide liability to pay levy. Example, in case of construction services in GST, it is written that when that each event gets completed, its slab gets completed, you have to account for that GST. That is given over there, that you will study in your IDT, but same thing will be applied over here, and that the activity which triggers the payment is completion of each slab. So accordingly it will be covered over here. Clear? Now many times it happens that reaching a minimum threshold, and when that minimum threshold is reached, then obligation to pay levy arises. So in that case, what to do? So reaching a minimum threshold or reaching a minimum threshold, then only obligation to pay levy arises. Then they say apply the normal principles. Example is like this, that first example is like this, that if the turnover crosses 20 lakhs, then you have to pay GST on the future supply which is going to happen. Now, if the turnover crosses 20 lakhs, then whatever future supply is there, on that future supply, whatever is the time of supply, based on the time of supply of the future supply, you have to pay GST. Now, the obligating event is the event which triggers the payment. And event which triggers the payment is the time of supply of that future supply. So, accordingly, the GST liability will be booked. You don't be book. See, when the day crosses 20 lakhs, I know okay, whenever there's a future sales and what's the time of supply of that future supply, I'll have to pay GST based on that. But I will not provide when the 20 lakh crosses. When that supply, future supply happens, I'll be providing for that. But sometimes it can be there that there's a limit of 1,50,000, and if the 1,50,000 limit crosses, you have to pay GST on the entire amount. So there's a possibility over here that when that 1,50,000 crosses, that triggers the payment. So it depends upon what thing triggers the payment, and based on the principles you have to apply, based on the logic you have to apply. They have not given a single answer over there. Clear? Now, whatever we just studied for this levy, for year, same concept has to be applied for a quarter. Means if you are doing quarterly accounting, then same thing. If there's quarterly accounting, then also the logic is same. The event which triggers the payment, is the obligating event, and then you book that liability to pay levy.
Even if it's a quarter, even if it's a year, no problem with that. Clear?
So what happens if we have paid earlier, but the liability to pay levy, that obligating event to pay levy, has not prepaid some taxes? Then it will be shown as a prepaid thing. It won't be shown as a levy till that time that obligating event happens. Okay, next. So conceptually, we are done with that Ind AS 37. Now distinguish between Ind AS 37 and AS 29. Now in Ind AS 37, specifically constructive obligation is given. Ind AS 37, specifically constructive obligation is given, and therefore the definitions of provisions, etc., revised to include that word constructive obligation. Further, the concept of that restructuring provision is also revised to include that word constructive obligation because of introduction of a word. In AS, there is no word constructive obligation which is used, but in AS it is written that sometimes to maintain good relationships, to maintain good business practices, you have to pay a certain amount and you will create a provision for the same. So that implies a constructive provision only, but not specifically named as constructive provision. Are you getting it? Constructive obligation. Next, in Ind AS, you know, we discount the provision whenever the time value of money is material. So maximum cases were discounted the provision. But in AS, at your lower levels, AS 29, only in one provision case, only in one provision, that is decommissioning restoration, that is the only case where the provision is discounted. No other case the provision is discounted in AS. In Ind AS, all the provisions are discounted provided time value of money is material. Next. In Ind AS, contingent asset, if it is probable, we disclose it in the financial statements, notes to accounts. But in AS is highly conservative. In AS, contingent asset, it is neither recognized nor disclosed in financial statement. If you want, you can disclose it in board of directors report. Clear? Next, onerous contract. In case of onerous contract in Ind AS, there is an extra requirement that before doing that accounting for the provision for that onerous contract, do one thing, check for impairment under Ind AS 36. That extra sentence is there in Ind AS, which is not there in AS. Next, future operating losses. In Ind AS, it is specifically given that future operating losses you cannot provide except onerous contract. In case of onerous contract, you need to provide the same. That sentence is missing in AS. Clear? Next, in Ind AS, we have extra guidance on rights to interest in decommissioning, restoration and environmental rehabilitation fund. Now, what is this? See, in Ind AS, there are three guidance. One is that right to interest in decommissioning, restoration, environmental rehabilitation fund. Then liabilities arising for participating in specific market, that is waste and electrical. And then levies. These are in the form of appendix. Out of that, appendix C to Ind AS 37, I have taught you, and that is a part of your syllabus. This A and B point are not there in detail. You should know just that some guidance is given on Ind AS, and there's no guidance on the same in AS. So levy you have in detail, but you don't have that A point and B point in detail. You should know just that there's some guidance on that A, B point that is not there in AS. Clear? That is there in Ind AS. Accordingly, we have completed the revision. You can go through the question answers. In first question, I had made that change, that I had added a draft. I had added that 2% note over there in whatever question was given in the module. And question number 5 of the module, I have cut that because I feel it should not be a question over here. It should be a question of 115. So you should cut that question number 5 from Ind AS 37. And accordingly, we are done with the revision of Ind AS 37.